Welcome aboard.
But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Of course.
Thud.
Fucking Monday. Who saw this coming?
I kind of saw it yesterday.
You did, huh?
Yeah, I thought it was going to come rolling around. And then I was right. There it is, Monday.
I had one of those rare nights where the kid was up. Damn it.
Oh, yeah?
I've been lucky. My kid sleeps through the night, but he's got... It's kid shit, I understand.
Is he colicky?
Well, no, thank God, no. I just got a bitch for 30 fucking seconds.
Colic.
I had to bring him to the doctor on Friday for his two-year checkup, even though it's a month past that, but they can't schedule you, right? Kid's completely fine. He's sick because he went to the doctor's office.
Oh, you're a lot of germs around.
Dude, you go in these fucking kid offices, kid doctor offices, and it's unbelievable how many sick kids are around. And then they have two rooms, one for sick kids and one for not sick kids.
Yeah.
If you go into the not sick kid room, that's when you get sick because everyone is trying to protect their prized possession.
He's not sick.
Yeah, why would you bring your sick kid and go, oh, I'm going to put him in the sick room?
Yeah.
I don't want to get him any sicker, so I'll go in the other room and make believe he's not sick.
Don't they have to go through all that, though, to get their immune system up and get those antibodies in for the illnesses? And
he gets sick enough hanging out with my family and go to the playground. I don't need, like, to take him to the doctor's office on a Friday, and he's, like, has the a horrendous cold now 2 days later.
Ugh.
Just so they could go, yeah, everything's fine.
Yeah.
So I was up off and on all night, but I'll be good. Ooh. I'll be good, I promise. I promise.
That's a treat,
huh?
Waking up like that.
Oh, it was horrible. I mean, I've been lucky. I need wood in my head.
Oh.
But besides that, I'm good. I'm good.
Welcome to this week.
My parents could relate to that shit. It's like, you just take him to the doctor's office. Aren't you avoiding your kid being sick? So why are we going to the doctor's office so many times?
Yeah. That usually happens with, like, regular old human, grown-up people, too.
Yeah,
you go to the doctor's office, or you visit someone in the hospital.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, I'm going to get sick.
Oh, God, when I have to visit someone in the hospital? Oh, my. I'm like, well, all right, what am I getting by the time I'm out of here?
That's when I look at the Chinese people and think, like, I think they got the right idea with those masks.
Yeah.
The Japanese people. Look at me. Chinese, Japanese,
what?
Yeah.
What is that, better?
Well,
they're all the same. They're all the same.
This is a good joke.
Rickles.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll get into Rickles in a second.
I'm Japanese. So. Are you Chinese or I'm Japanese. No, I'm Chinese. What is that, better?
I think there would be a nice little business to have your doctors come to your house like the old days.
The old house call.
I'm serious.
You ever get a house call?
Make the rounds.
Were you around during the time of the house call?
Oh, God, no. When did that end, you think?
I don't know. I remember a house call once.
You had a doctor come to your house?
Yeah, Dr. Fuchs.
Dr. Fuchs?
Dr. Fuchs.
What did Dr. Fuchs do?
Exactly. That's exactly
how did
what
he spell
I thought when it was.
F-U-C-H-S?
It was my pediatrician. It was
really?
Her. And she would.
What was her first name?
I don't know.
Anita?
She was like, I honestly think she was
your dad?
Like running from the Nazis.
Oh, sorry.
No, running from the Nazis.
What?
She was some older fucking German woman.
And she came to your house?
Yeah, it was house calls back in like the 67, 68.
Did she squeeze your testicles?
When I was a little tater tot. No.
No squeezing of the testicles?
Just put a thermometer under your tongue, never up the ass. And, I give you a little medicine. She came in with a little doctor bag and stethoscope and stuff.
Nice.
You were sick at home. I feel like it was 1928.
Yeah. This one you should have kept to yourself. I know people are understanding that we're a bit older, but
Dr. Fuchs.
I don't remember a house call.
It was Dr. Fuchs.
I promise you that. It must have been a deal your dad was making. He might have bartered some shit.
Nah, I don't think so.
No?
I think the doctors used to do that in, like, even the late 60s.
Yeah.
You could do them in Canada. When I was up there last year, my girlfriend was sick, and we had a doctor come to the hotel. You can get house calls.
I would love that.
Do that. It's much easier.
Anyone, doctor is preferably really sexy with a nice bus line. If you want to come to my house...
I bet they stopped it. I bet they stopped it because of some litigation. It's probably like, well, if they come to your house, then it's not a, you know, it's something happens.
No, I know what it is.
Yeah.
They want to shove as many patients in a day as possible because they make so much more money. So why would they waste their time going and traveling from house to house?
Well, that's the house calls are usually after hours, too, which is a weird thing.
Oh, really?
You like, call up the doctor and they come over at like 8 at night.
Really?
Oh, it was like a little house on the prairie.
With one button undone?
No, not Dr. Fuchs.
No, you didn't want to see Dr.
Fuchs.
Fuchs
was an old Nazi woman.
Yeah.
That's all I know.
Whatever. So he's now has a fucking cold because he went to the doctor. I know that's the reason, too. He was completely fucking fine. Not even a close to a sniffle. Frustrating.
Wait, is that what happened when you were a kid? The Nazi doctor? That's probably what it was. Oh. Anthony would be... You're sick because of your Jews. The Jews made you sick.
You think I mean, fix you up.
You think she was whispering in his ear?
Of course she was.
Yeah.
And she started him down this road.
Yes, the lady who made him feel better was a Nazi.
That we get to enjoy to this day.
Remember who made you feel better.
I will fix you up.
I will fix you up.
And I want to say one more thing.
Yeah.
I was just telling you guys.
I hope more than one. We got a long show.
Oh, fuck that. I'm going to throw out my
shit. Just one more thing and that's it.
I'm going to throw out my shit in the next half hour and I'm just going to sit back and relax.
I'm going to coast.
I'm going to coast today. Today's my day to coast.
Coast.
We always bitch about customer service, but lately we kind of like what? The Apple Store is amazing.
The Apple Store is always good, yeah.
And after that, B&H is amazing.
Boy.
And then after that, I couldn't tell you. Until this fucking weekend. I went to Yankee Stadium. I haven't been to Yankee Stadium in a while. Maybe a year. I think it's about a year.
Yeah.
Their customer service is beyond amazing. And I have to say it.
Yeah.
I got primo seats for the Subway Series. I want to thank a certain individual that's a huge fan of the show but doesn't want to be mentioned by name.
Oh.
But I was treated like a fucking rock star. But from the time I got to Yankee Stadium all the way to where I was sitting and all the way back out to my car to drive home, every single person that worked at Yankee Stadium couldn't be nicer.
Yeah.
And I have to say this because we bitch all the time how people out there suck at their jobs and customer service sucks. Service with a smile the entire fucking time. And Jimmy said, was it because you were sitting in kind of a VIP area? No, because I had to get to my seats.
Right.
When I pulled in for parking, I had a couple questions, and they couldn't have been nicer. When I was walking in, they're like, enjoy the game, enjoy the game. That's all I kept hearing from all over the place. I kept turning my head. Enjoy the game. And then we got some concessions before we got to our area, and they couldn't have been nicer. It was unbelievable. I don't know. Somebody actually said something way up top. Like,
really?
Like if we catch you not being pleasant, we're going to fire you. It's obvious.
Wow, really?
Because they were going so out of their way. A lot of times, I wasn't looking at these people and I heard their voices coming at me like, you know, have a nice night, get home safely, all this shit.
Maybe because they're not exactly tearing things up this season.
The Yankees?
Yeah, it's like, we got to keep people coming back.
They're doing all right, though. They're in it.
Yeah.
They're right there. But I have to say it because usually, you know, you go to a sporting event or something, it's just like, ugh.
Oh, I know. Just treated like one of the masses.
Oh, yeah, they're just pushing you
cattle.
Like cattle, you know?
Yeah.
But maybe this has been going on a while. You know, that's how out of touch I am. I don't go to a lot of baseball games anymore.
I haven't been to one game this year.
Maybe one a year, and I just noticed that and just wanted to mention it. So whoever fucking, you know, is doing that up there, I certainly appreciate it.
Whipping them into shape.
I certainly appreciate
it. Nice.
How much are tickets now? I haven't been in a while either, but I would go.
I don't know.
Like, do you know in general, Sam? I'm curious what a Yankee team
I honestly don't know. Where I was sitting is the Legends seats, whatever, where you get all the free food and stuff.
Is it free?
They fucking hammer you out if you want booze.
They bang you out.
Mm.
What kind of food do they have?
Really nice, man. They had a whole table. All it was cotton candy and peanuts.
Oh, really?
Oh, man.
And take as much as you want. Then they had ice cream coolers with ice cream sandwiches. And I was on my best behavior. I'm like, my brother certainly wasn't. My brother took advantage. Holy fuck. Lobster roll sandwiches, hot dogs,
chicken fingers. Great.
He just kept going back for more. And I'm like shaking because I'm trying to I just don't want to eat like that.
What you gotta do is just tip, right? You throw it to the person.
Oh yeah, give them a nice tip. But they bang you out if you want a few beers. That's how they get you. They bang you out for the beers.
Yeah, and that's, you know, what you want at the ball game.
Those apple pies that are like, you know, those kind of deep fried apple pie things that we all know from McDonald's.
Mm.
They had those.
I want to go to
their
a ball
own version.
Game.
It was great.
I want to sit in a legend seat and eat like a gentleman. Coffee, please.
It was great. I had a really good time. I'm going back. I still haven't been to the new Mets Stadium. City Field.
City Field.
I've been to the new Yankee Stadium twice now. Tickets where I was sitting are what?
Well, they run between $575
and $15. I'll take the $15
one. $15.
It'll be probably up higher.
Why'd you do the big number first?
Because he's a dope, that's why.
I just saw the...
No, nobody reversed.
No, the seats are more than that.
Yes, they are.
Because they give you all the free food and stuff. That's their way of trying to justify it.
They always go. They go from $15 up to, you know...
Well, I didn't have any thought process. I just wrote down this number and then I scrolled down. Oh, did we get the
Since
message
Since you started
across?
Here. No, I thought it was $1,500.
No, I think
you did not.
I did.
Yeah, so did
you
I.
You thought the lowest price, the lowest ticket in the stadium was $575?
No, not in the stadium, in the Legends area.
Oh.
Yeah, we were going for Legends area.
Very confusing.
I think the tickets are more than $575.
They
really
start at $575.
Okay.
No, see, Sam has just butchered this.
Yeah, no.
Go to break.
Then you can have
now that's confused.
Yeah, let's get the music going. It's terrible.
I think it's outrageous. I think it's over 1,000 for some of those seats.
I think you're right.
Some of them are. Sure.
They are, yeah.
But the Yankees don't think so. They're going to end their relationship with StubHub at the end of the year because they think that StubHub artificially deflates the prices of their expensive tickets.
Really?
So they're going to come up with their own ticket system so that season ticket holders can charge as much.
And
as
isn't it true that that area is pretty empty during the games and the rest of the stadium is full?
During a lot of them, yeah, because they're so expensive.
Yeah.
And you've got 81
It's like the first
home
10,
games.
It's like the first 10 rows or something like that?
Yeah.
Or, I don't know, maybe 8 rows?
I want to sit there.
Like, they're not, it's not a football game, you know? There's not 7 of them a year. There's 81.
Right.
So how many people are really going to pay X amount of dollars to go to one insignificant game?
Who's the old guy that probably would have, who used to hit the fucking thing?
Frankie Says.
Oh, I was so happy.
Hand guy? Clang, clang, clang.
Frankie Says.
I was so happy when I heard he died. Good. Stop disturbing everybody. Fucking clang.
Freddie Says, I'm sorry.
Freddie says.
He's trying to, trying to have a good good fucking day at the park.
He's
all nice. Clang, clang, clang.
Oh, exactly.
Enough of him.
They all know him. Hey, Freddie, how's your pots and pans doing? A clang, clang.
Freddie
fucking
Says.
Boo.
Yankee swept the Mets, huh, in that Subway Series?
They sure did.
That's a big deal for the New York area.
Yeah.
Oh, Mets are starting to fade. Lost 6 out of the last 7.
Ugh.
Not that I'm a Mets fan right
like
now.
Him?
Look at his cell phone hanging off his neck, his Motorola Razor.
That's good.
You didn't like Freddie Says?
I certainly didn't.
Why not?
I hate any fan that everyone knows.
Hate them. You're not a fan of the super fan.
No, it's embarrassing.
Super fan,
just go watch the game.
I love the super fan.
Oh, just go clap when they make a home run and shut the fuck up. Yeah, two-run dinger. Let's go home.
Hey, man, if it wasn't for the super fan, we wouldn't know when to cheer.
I got to be there. The people depend on me. They don't give a shit.
They look forward to seeing me clang my pots and pans. Yeah, the kids, they bring the kids over. We take pictures. I clang the pot and pan.
I go to Jets games, and I don't know when to cheer, but goddamn, Fireman Ed tells me when, and I'm like, thank you, Fireman Ed.
Thank God for Fireman Ed.
Wait, you're going to keep everyone quiet right now? Okay, it seems like a good idea.
He thinks he's making a difference.
Ugh.
Everyone will just sit there quietly if he's not there. Jets score like a touchdown, and he'd be like, everybody's just sitting there going, what do we do?
Right.
I don't know. Should I cheer?
Well, let's look at Fireman Ed. He'll let us
Fireman
know.
Fireman Ed. Oh, he's saying, yeah.
I'm not
make noise.
I'm not a big fan of the super fan either, but I'll say this. I've been to enough Jets games. Fireman Ed, you got to, like, really break this down. He was just a dude. And somewhere along the line, how did it get to a point where the entire stadium will actually shut their fucking mouths until he says it's time to, you know, get something going?
I don't know.
Look, how do you build that?
A certain amount of blame has to be placed on the Jets.
Well, the Jets eventually decided to acknowledge him. And
they put him on the scoreboard.
But yeah,
he had to be
But how did he get to that point?
Yeah.
Is what happened? Who saw him and said, hey, that guy is pretty good?
He obviously was a nuisance in his area for many years.
Do you think he was reported a lot? Like, this guy just won't shut up.
Because he would get on his, brother-in-law's shoulders, is it? Or I think it's his brother-in-law's
shoulders.
And so, you know, he was a nuisance at first.
That guy's got to hate being who he is.
Yeah.
Well, you see, he's just the guy that has to carry Fireman Ed on his shoulders.
Oh yeah,
he's always cropped out of pictures.
Yeah, look, we just Google imaged Fireman Ed, and you can see the top of a bald head. That's it.
Yep,
that's the guy.
He's the guy that's been propping him up for years.
His back smells like Ed's asshole.
Oh God,
he's tired of it.
He's the Virgil of the Jets.
Because you know there are super fans trying to do this at every game, and they're failing miserably. But somewhere along the line, Fireman Ed fucking got some momentum going.
How did it happen?
The kids love me. You know, they come up. I always bang the pots and pans. One little fella, he wanted to hold the pan for the picture.
Oh,
I said, sure, hold the pan, little guy. Go ahead, bang it. And he was missing. He said, go ahead and clang it together. You know, I teach him how to clang the pots and pans because I'm not going to be here forever.
Hey, uncomfortable laughter.
We're going to have a stadium full of Freddy Scissors.
Freddy Scissors?
Yeah.
No,
everyone yelling Freddy Scissors and hitting their pots and pans.
That should be Bobo's new job. Become a super fan for the Mets.
He already thinks he's...
Yeah, but he should hit a fucking pot with a stick of old dynamite. That's fucking dripping.
Old sweating dynamite.
Nice. He'd be able to get in the games for free. That's Freddy never paid for a game.
Wow,
did
really?
Yeah, they just let him in.
As of when, though? Probably like...
For a long time.
How many years was he going?
I don't know how many years he
probably
was going,
since,
but
like
he was going for a long time. Oh. But then when
did
they give him a seat though, or they say you can come in and just wander around?
He just wandered around, and then I remember reading something about when the new stadium opened, like they weren't going to let him in.
Good.
And then there was this big fan uproar.
Why?
Oh,
because the fans love Freddy Scissors.
No, they don't. He's all loud.
Hey, you know, a bunch of guys are calling saying that Fireman Ed is a phony. He started out as a Miami fan.
Uh oh.
He's not even born and bred.
Oh, good.
Let me say hi to Tommy in Chicago. Tommy.
What's going on, guys?
Norton's going to be up there soon in Chicago.
Yes.
Hey,
Hey,
this guy's a load of crap.
What, Tommy?
We used to have a guy in for the Cubs. He died a couple years ago. His name was Ronnie Woo Woo.
Tommy, that's not why I took
Ronnie
your call.
Woo Woo.
Are you saying that? Who fucked up on the lines? Because now they changed what this guy wanted to talk about. Someone's trying to cover their tracks. Someone's trying to cover their tracks. E-Rock. Who is it?
That would be one of our interns, Connor.
Connor. All right, throw him in the ocean.
Wait, so a kid that's like barely 18 or 19 comes off the street, and within a week he's now screening calls for a great radio show. That's
and this one as well.
That seems fun. Why don't we have a phone screener today?
Because the interns are the phone screeners now.
Oh.
When did that happen?
As soon as they gave us interns back.
What's this guy talking about?
All right, what's Ronnie Woo Woo? Let's hear Ronnie Woo Woo. Maybe it's a good story.
To screen phone calls after a week or two on the gig?
Supervised.
Pretty important
phone calls.
Pretty important, though. They got to know, you know, what's a good call, what we want to talk about, topical for what we're talking about. They can't just throw people through willy-nilly.
Thank you. We only take a certain amount of calls every day.
Yes.
They're not a secretary.
What, Tommy?
Phone screener.
What was I supposed to talk about? I can make some shit up.
No, Ronnie Woo Woo, we want to hear. Whatever.
Yeah,
what's up with Mr. Woo Woo?
Yeah, what's up with Ronnie Woo Woo?
Who was he?
The reason I didn't want to take this call is because we did this break a million fucking times. Hence why I'm kind of mad that a dumb intern is fucking taking our phone call today.
Oh, wow.
E-Rock, fix that shit.
Yeah, find a smart one.
All right, what's up with Ronnie Woo Woo? We'll humor you.
He had about, like, 6 teeth, and every word he said, he had to add woo to. So it was like, Sammy, woo, so, woo. Every single time he had an interview.
Does it sound familiar?
Woo, every other word.
I don't know.
Besides me.
So he basically had Tourette's.
We did the same break.
Or did he have Tourette's?
He must have.
That's awful. So, woo. Oh, yuck.
Yeah, we don't like him either.
Did he die alone?
Yes,
alone.
Funny. My heart. Woo.
Do you smell his rotting teeth?
Who's rotting teeth?
Ronnie Woo Woo, when he was alive. If he's dead, I don't even care. Did the guy say he's dead?
He didn't acknowledge it.
Oh.
Did you want to know about Fireman Ed and his Dolphins history?
Well, yeah, there's another guy calling about that.
All right, thank you, Ronnie.
Ryan in the Bronx. What?
What's up, man? I'm a Jet fan, but this dude is a fucking Dolphin fan, man. He was on the fan talking to Joe Beningo, and Beningo brought it up to him, and he's like, oh, yeah, well, I grew up, my brother was a Dolphin fan, and, you know, when you're young, you're influenced, and it's like, you can't be the fucking phony face of, like, you know, like, this dude It's the biggest fucking shit dog in the world.
Uh-huh.
And he gets mad at you if you don't listen to him, you know?
Okay. He was a Dolphins fan.
Until Dolphins fan. You can look it up.
Yep, we looked it up. Until the age of 10. 10.
And then fake fan. Yeah,
10.
Wait, he became a Jets fan at 10?
At 10.
See, my dad brought a banner home from Minnesota once, so I became a Twins fan for a summer.
Exactly.
But I was 8.
I was a Santa Claus fan.
I was 8 years old.
10.
Right.
I don't think it really matters.
That's even better. Fireman Ed was a Dolphins fan and a Santa Claus fan at the same time.
Yeah, well, Fireman Ed don't bleed jet green.
Oh, shit.
that intern stole my thunder. He sucks. I'll see you guys later.
Yeah, all right, take care.
I fucking hate these new
intern.
No, they're nice kids.
I fucking hate them.
One good-looking one.
I mean,
the good-looking one has a weird thing going on, though.
What?
Wait, you want to save it for your fucking show?
No, and I haven't said this on the air yet. This is exclusively for
Anthony. All right, finally, bring it something.
He's got webbed toes.
What?
Ew.
Like, legitimately?
Why? Like, I saw his foot, and he's got a big toe, and then the rest of the toes are stuck together.
What, is he a mutant?
Why?
I gotta see his foot.
Why so weird.
Why wouldn't you cut that shit?
I don't know, that's what I said.
Although, man, imagine having that when you're in a pool.
It could be very helpful.
Yeah, everybody's fleeing in horror.
Do you want to see his water world?
Yes, I want to see.
Does he have gills behind his ears?
That's what I asked. Okay.
Are we allowed to see his toes? Or?
I think Eric has to be in here.
Oh, we're allowed to? You sure?
Yeah, I have to be in there.
As long as Travis is in here.
E-Rock has to be in here when the interns come in?
No, he doesn't.
You're wrong.
Who said that E-Rock has to be in the room?
Not me.
Who did?
E-Rock,
I have to keep an eye on them. I'll be right there.
No, A-Rock, I don't want you in the studio right now. I want you right there.
Oh, no.
You can see them from right there.
You're kidding, right? Someone told you you have to come in the studio when we have an intern in the studio?
I have to watch their interactions with you guys.
What do you know?
Who told you that? Who told you that?
Told you that?
One of our bosses.
Who?
Look at the fear.
Which one?
Look at the fear in this fucking place.
You. He's shook. Was it Rob?
I think you can...
No, I don't.
I think you could...
Which one?
We don't have time for this shit. Which idiot said this?
I gotta just be protective of what goes on with them when they're in the studio.
What were you told?
Which dummy?
I was told that if there's interactions with the interns where it seems like it's can be confrontational or heated, and the intern's not aware that maybe it's a joke or something like that, I have to be on top of it.
You debrief them after their studio appearance.
Did you tell that guy?
What? No, not that guy. What guy before?
No, the intern, I mean. Did you tell him that we were joking?
Yes, I did.
Of course. We were joking. I mean, I laughed in the middle of it.
Yes.
What guy told you have to be in studio?
E-Rock,
comment.
We're asking you.
Yeah. I know you're asking me,
stop
but
being
it just
shy.
Makes it more difficult.
I don't
makes
give
what
a
difficult?
Fuck. They've already made this job ridiculously difficult. How could it be any worse? Take your beating. Who's told you?
There is a climate of fear in this place.
Answer the question.
To not talk about.
You get to leave.
No, but so do you eventually. Hopefully soon.
But do you understand they're brainwashing you guys behind the scenes to try to make us behave, and that's never going to happen, so give us the fucking name. Thank you.
And when you're asked on the air, you got to answer. It's not like you brought it up.
It's a radio show.
I was talked to by Gary.
Oh,
fucking rat.
What did he say, though?
A rat.
Jesus.
That I have to be...
We tested him, and he failed.
Exactly. You might fold under questioning.
You just broke the guy code. That's
exactly.
That's some fucked up shit right there.
Jesus.
Never.
What's wrong with you?
Oh,
we're not going to do anything crazy.
Gary is so out of touch with what goes on.
He's such a dope.
I just want to
see. Nice guy, but he's a dope. I just want to see the boy's webbed feet. I've never seen webbed feet.
Oh, well, wait. E-Rock's got to come in. Come on,
E-Rock. Come on in and supervise.
I want to see how you handle this.
Yeah, I want to see E-Rock's supervision skills. Come on, quickly. And play this, dude. Sal's there. Okay.
Oh, good.
They got someone covering the board. All right, that makes sense.
Sal.
Dude, Sal.
I always think that now.
Come on, E-Rock, hurry up. The bit's over.
Oh, there he is.
He took too long to get here. Nobody wants to see his webbed feet anymore.
So you think you're going to catch shit?
Not sure what's that for. Supper?
You think you're going to catch shit?
Supper man.
Yes.
Supper man.
Not to go on an old bit, but you said that about that shit.
I know.
So.
I remember.
How about shit?
I'm pulling out of the
I pull them out of the old catalog every so often.
You went with stupid, too, right?
I don't think I did.
Soup? Did you go with stupid? Have we said that one?
I think Jimmy went with stupid again.
I'm sure you did it.
Simpleton?
Some point. Whether I was wearing the shirt or not.
Oh, so, rock. I didn't mean it.
Are you going to catch shit now that you've mentioned Gary by name?
Well, I have to let him know that an intern is in studio on air, so I have to send an email.
And right now?
Know. Yeah, right now.
Well, so what could he possibly do? He's not even awake yet.
Wait a minute.
Stop asking questions.
Look, he's actually writing a text to Gary because we have an intern in studio.
You have to send it. It says intern is in studio every time there's an intern in studio?
I have to let him know that if an intern's going to be part of a segment or something, that he should be aware.
Well, how about he just listens to the show or somebody listens to the show?
I thought that, too, based on Friday, but I'm supposed to let him
know. How about he comes in every day, even though we don't want to see his stupid face and supervise from afar?
Yeah.
If he's so concerned about this.
Ugh. All right, take your clothes off. Okay, I want to see your webbed feet.
Don't even joke what? Like that.
How, all right.
Ah. Is it bad?
Wow!
Back up a little.
Ah. Put your foot up on the console.
I can't get close.
They look like normal toes.
No, the middle one.
What?
The middle one and the...
pull them apart.
The one next to the big toe is stuck together completely.
Oh, my God. Sir, how tall are you?
Oh, my God.
I'll pull it apart.
I'm 5'7". You can't get your foot up there?
I got tight pants on.
Oh, my God.
Certainly do.
Oh, my God. The fucking toes are all webbed and stuff.
What kind
of... Hold on a second. Handsome. Let me take a picture of your toes.
What happened there?
Wow-wee.
What's that about?
I was just born that way.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, really? So, I hope you didn't have that
really?
Done.
I thought your parents melted them together. But what is it?
Wow. What did the doctor say? What did your pediatrician say?
Well,
to throw this one off of the cliff in Sparta. Yeah. Web feet.
Wow.
Said, I can't get them cut until I'm older.
How old you got to be to get them cut?
Well, like, now I can, but like before, and now it's just like, why?
And they just slice through. Why?
Why?
I can think of two reasons.
No, you can't tell they're together.
You play footsie with a girl and she's screaming.
Yeah, you can tell they're together. Believe me. Yeah. Now, is it a foot like that too?
Yeah.
On the same place?
Yeah. It's like a little bit less, but yeah.
But dude, your toes are webbed. You've got webbed toes. You got to fix that.
Can we cut them on the air?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
How long does it take to heal if they cut them?
I don't know. I have no clue.
Oh, Iraq, get another email out there quick. Talking about
Here's how we want to cut them, with just a really good scissors. Like, slice down.
How about rusty scissors?
No, I want a nice, clean slice.
You want a nice slice?
Plastic safety scissors.
So what you have to do is, you'd have to cut between
the
them.
Ones.
Yeah. Oh.
And sew around. Would you have to put extra skin there because you're adding... You would, right? Yeah. You'd have to graft from somewhere.
What? What are you talking about?
If you cut his little tootsies, there's not enough skin probably to wrap around both toes because...
It could stretch in his pull it there and sew it together?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe.
Think.
Can I refer to them as freakish things? Those freakish...
Is it just those two that are stuck together or is
and
everything
then,
else weird?
The same. No, that's it.
I was born, my asshole was like that.
Oh,
fused.
Kind of hurt.
God, that
big
looks...
water balloon of shit hanging from your ass.
That looks a painful, man. Like, if they cut that...
Yeah.
How long do they see beyond crutches for? What's the healing time?
I don't know. I never asked.
Are you going to get it done or not?
Probably not.
Does it affect you in any way?
No.
You're running?
Have any girls ever thought it was gross?
No, one thought it was hot.
Oh,
no,
she didn't.
No one thinks it's
she
hot.
She said,
relax.
I want to suck your toes.
Did she?
I swear
did
on my life.
Oh, no.
Wow, webbed. They're all webbed.
It was in school, so it was kind of...
Wow, that's pretty
together
cool.
Together ones, she wanted to suck on you.
I thought you went to an all-boy school.
This was in grammar school.
It's when they called a girl.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow, that's fucked up right there.
Yeah.
I don't even know your name.
Iraq, are we okay?
Yeah, no, I don't know. He was watching TV instead of supervising.
Yeah, you were talking about cutting the intern's toes
off. I saw.
He's like, yeah!
He's looking at the TV screens.
Friday's ad. All right.
Iraq, are we doing well?
We're doing fine.
This is so insulting, I can't even fucking tell you.
What, that Iraq has to be in here?
It's ridiculous. That's stupid
that
fucking egghead.
Supervising us.
Making
Thanks.
Sure you guys don't
More, yeah,
stay
yeah.
within the boundaries.
Right.
Of...
Yeah, God forbid we get a little crazy.
Did he say, look,
God
need...
forbid. That's why people listen to radio shows. Doesn't this egghead understand that?
I need you to be my eyes and ears in the studio.
Hey, Rock, what are you supposed to do if something happens that you deem unacceptable?
I'm supposed to diffuse the situation and
dump out
him.
Of the show and go right to a record.
You're supposed to diffuse the situation.
Yeah. They should be my eyes and ears and stomach.
I guarantee that was said.
So what are you supposed to do?
So if he did something and you guys got really mad at him, like he really screwed up over something, and it was getting hostile, I have to remove him from the situation.
Remove him?
Yes.
So you bodily take him and lead him out the door?
Yeah, I have to, because that's not why they're here. They're not supposed to be treated that way. And
really?
I have to look out for his best interest.
Oh, interesting. Wow, yeah. Mm. You seem to remember a show that, you know, has interns that do things. I mean, yeah. I don't know. Well, he knows best, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, so far, so good.
Oh, good.
Thank you.
I'd hate to have you, you know, carry him over your shoulder out the door.
Bodily remove him.
Save him, thank goodness.
What letter grade would you give Opie and Anthony on their treatment of the intern tonight?
Oh, right now, you got an A+.
Oh,
congratulations,
wow.
Guys.
Wow. Are you sure it's an A+, though? Because we did make fun of what is, might I say, a deformity.
Words hurt.
And what if he gets scared of the toes being cut?
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't told me otherwise, so far.
Can we cut your toes? We could, right? How do we do it? Let's do this.
Well,
I give permission.
Yeah, let's cut one.
Well, see, that's not good enough here.
Why don't you put him on the mic so people can hear him together?
Yeah. Why is the supervisor taking up all the...
Yeah, why is the supervisor hogging the mic?
Get back in position, supervisor.
Exactly, you supervise.
He's supervising us.
How insulting.
That is so insulting.
That stupid egghead. Go away.
Ouch.
What? You don't like when I call him egghead?
I didn't say I didn't like it, but I'm just pointing out that that's also insulting.
I think he's a smart guy, but I don't think he's smart at radio at all. Especially this type of radio.
I don't really think anybody is qualified to supervise the show.
Yeah. It's
just, I mean,
he's a dope and he's lazy. Because he should be supervising. Trust me, me and Jimmy don't want bosses around. But he's making E-Rock do what he probably should be doing in his job description.
I just have to look out for his best
E-Rock
interest.
Lazy.
Ah, nah. Yeah. Oh. I mean, we do for the show, like, but
what?
E-Rock works
hard.
No,
E-Rock hustles.
Yeah, that's what? What I, so that's why.
For the show, he's lazy, but I know damn well he works hard.
What?
Yeah, no, he comes early, stays late every day.
Yeah.
What?
Comes
every
late,
day.
Stays yeah. late.
Huh?
Oh, he doesn't work the hardest, but he does work hard.
Yeah.
On what spectrum?
Working hard or hardly working.
The intern's going to have to remove E-Rock because this is a hostile atmosphere. They're in cahoots.
Yeah.
Let me prove my point.
Lean him out.
Let me prove my point. E-Rock, did AK write you back?
Can't make him drink.
Did he write you back?
Yeah, he said it's not necessary to let me know every time they're in here. It was to let him know.
Well, now he's trying
when
to
their situations
yeah. because we brought it yeah. up on the air. Now
a
he's
situation.
Trying to say face.
What would you deem
I,
a situation?
I guess I mistook what he said. Oh. I thought it was to let him know anytime and not just like bringing food or something, but if they were in here for a segment
wow,
or
he
a
put
discussion.
Some fear in your head.
He really did scare
that
you.
Sucks.
You're
petrified.
You
don't
yeah.
need this gig.
Ha ha.
Why do you got fear?
Because you Mega leave fortune. At 10, and when I still have to deal with this.
Just
once you leave,
just openly with it like laugh adult. At the guy.
Yeah,
yeah.
He said deal with it like an adult, yeah. And then Opie said openly laugh at the guy at the same time.
You think he's getting mixed messages?
Yeah, you're scared
I'm
of him.
I'm trying to deal with this the best way possible.
You're scared of him?
Yeah,
no.
Yes, you are.
God.
Ugh. You shook up.
No, I'm scared.
Sam,
of,
are you scared of those guys?
No.
Of course not.
No.
Of course not. What's wrong with you, E-Rock?
I got a house I'm paying for, so.
The Nagel.
The Stanchion.
Castle Nagel. Castle.
Can we paper cut your fucking toes?
Fuck, yeah, with an envelope.
Come on, let's do it.
Get the phone out, E-Rock.
They're doing it. You have to ask him?
I think we could get that done.
What?
He said he would let us paper cut in between his toes.
That's because he's not looking out for his own best interest. That's
true.
Why
he gave the okay, so I can check on it.
Okay, check with the boss.
Double check.
You want to use a manila envelope.
See if we could paper cut his toes separated.
Just try to separate him with a manila envelope. Manila.
Oof. Manila. Ow, that would hurt really bad.
Okay, I used to think it was vanilla because I thought it was the color of vanilla. I think there was a time I thought that. I'm just bringing that to the discussion. I don't anymore. I promise you that. You just fucking wrote Egghead.
No.
I'll see
if it's okay.
She says, yeah. I think
that's his name. Roland's strolling down the hall. I'm going to ask him. I'll ask him about Egghead. He's not scared of Egghead.
He's got
what?
Whole other world of issues.
what's his problems?
Roland just is constantly dealing with
nothing.
Issues.
Nonsense.
Yeah. So they said that.
Oh, wow, Jimmy. I like your picture.
Oh, yes. I sent out.
I didn't see that from my vantage point.
Yeah, I sent out.
Yeah, you got to fix that shit.
Intern's Tootsies. I Twittered it.
Is that okay that it's been Twittered? Uh oh. Yeah.
You got
Oh, man. Oh, no permission.
You got two. You got two big toes.
Yeah.
On your foot, basically. Wow. That's impressive. Roland, are you scared of Egghead?
Which one?
Gary is Egghead. Does he put the fear in your head, too, like he has E-Rock, obviously?
I respect him.
God, what do these guys do to you?
Roland is making a dick in the ass motion.
You weren't supposed to say that part.
No.
Oh, sorry.
You idiot.
No,
not bad.
I like what Michael J. Fox has.
Oh, you shake up a little bit.
Yeah, that shit.
I gotcha.
You know what happened in that DNA strand that told those toes not to fucking come apart?
Oh, what foot?
I don't know. And why on both sides?
Yeah, it's so weird. Mm-hmm. Like one little fucking message that it's supposed to be. Yeah, and these things are separate. And never got the fucking message.
It just
message.
Didn't. It got distracted.
Never got the message.
And the separate toes message went somewhere else. Probably somewhere horrible, like his nipples are probably fucking split in half.
Eric, we get an answer back on the paper cut thing?
Nothing yet.
Nothing yet. So let's do it then.
Oh. Eric, this is going to be your call.
Ow!
I can't even imagine how much that hurts.
Handsome Rob, Jesus.
You want to do this?
I saw it on Jackass.
And then we really got to put alcohol on it so it doesn't paper cut. Get infected.
Oh, he's cut
I don't know if we're allowed to do that yet.
Oh, you hear E-Rock?
The
supervisor.
Supervisor.
What'd they cut on Jackass?
What are the S's for?
Tongue, the corner of the mouth. it's like it's killing me just thinking about this.
The corner
I'm
of the
all
mouth,
and the webbing between your fingers.
See, that's all we're doing here today.
I literally have goosebumps thinking about that. It's so.
You do remember
painful.
We used to shove cell phones, big ones, because they were big back then, up girls' pussies, right?
That's right. This is around and Wall now Street time. That phone.
And now we're sitting around waiting to see if we could paper cut a guy. Eric. Just got an email.
Uh-oh. Let's see.
I love doing this to show how pathetic this whole fucking business has become. Go ahead, E-Rock.
What does it
with
say,
a very E-Rock? Predictable answer.
Well, my question was answered with a question.
Of course it was. Non-committal.
What was the question?
I wasn't given permission nor told I wasn't allowed to.
Or denied, you said.
But that too. what do I think? Do you think this is a good idea?
What do you think? They put it on you? This isn't your show.
Say yes. Yeah.
You
work here's your
for
answer.
This show.
Yeah. Sure supervisor. I do. It's a paper cut. Sure I do. Semicolon. It's a paper cut.
And write Egghead in there somewhere. I
you're going to get Eric confused because he's going to be scared of you too.
E-Rock, I demand you put Egghead in your response.
Okay.
I demand. Where are you going to put it? It's got to be in a good spot.
Sent from.
Yeah, sure I do. Semicolon.
It's a paper cut.
It's a paper cut, comma.
Reference him as Egghead in your response. Yeah. Don't send yet.
Here he goes. What is that, a BlackBerry?
He's typing.
Ew, writing, what are they doing?
Writing it in their language.
But why in a fucking BlackBerry?
You're writing it in what language?
This is the only way I can get my corporate email.
Who wants it?
You're right.
That's not true anymore, by the way.
That's right.
Well, I don't have that permission, so.
Uh-huh. Oh.
This is what I got.
They sent me. I wonder how many corporate emails are to my fucking SiriusXM address.
Oh, my God.
I've never checked it.
Never. I've never checked it either.
There truly is no reason to.
Yeah, no. It's like, let's see what's going on in all the departments.
Great.
Hey, it looks like the 40s channel's having a horn contest. Man, really? Oh, fuck you.
Oh, this was supposed to be something great.
I want to be involved.
It was
in
supposed to be something great.
Oh.
What's the email say?
Sorry, can't help it.
Oh, did Jimmy just blast one out?
I can't help it. I was waiting for this email to be sent. I got nailed. That's my overeager button.
Nailed E-Rock really badly.
E-Rock, your email back to Egghead.
Oh. It says, I believe, comma, with intern's permission, comma, it would not be a big deal. Oh. Egghead. As,
did you put a comma before egghead?
I put in parentheses as commanded to insert by Opie.
No, that's not you writing it then.
You didn't send this yet, right?
No, I did not send this.
Take the Opie part out.
Okay.
Take the parentheses part out. He'll know.
Parentheses.
Oh, boy.
Oh, God.
And it's obvious you're just throwing it in there. I want it to be part of the flow of your response.
Yes.
In conclusion, egghead. Something like that.
Furthermore.
Egghead.
Fucking roll.
It's rolling, laughing at.
Okay. And sent.
Mm. Oh, it's sent.
Well, how did you end up using egghead?
To end the email. It just says, I believe with the intern's permission, it would not be a big deal, egghead.
Now send it. Let's get this moving.
God, I hope he gets fired over this.
Insubordination.
That's so disrespectful.
That'd be hilarious.
It really is.
To show audio from today.
Oh, wow. Well,
they're not your, masters.
Yeah, we're not your fucking...
Just suggesting.
Just like you're not running this
you
show.
You got your own mind, man.
We're not the boss of 40 you.
40 years old. Mm-hmm. You can make your own decisions.
Mm-hmm. He is 40 years right? old.
I thought... You're not?
No.
Oh. Next year, though. No. My mistake.
Next year, you can be 40. Fuck, we got to throw a big...
Seven more years.
Big house and everything.
Yeah, nice
before
big house.
40? Wow.
Outdoor movie theater.
That's pretty
Malayan
good.
Malayan Falcon Legos.
Mm-hmm. I like how that was third on your list. Huge things.
So now we're down to whether or not we could paper cut people on this show. That's terrific.
Yeah.
Do you want some home run calls from the Yankee game?
Yeah. Oh, I do.
Yeah.
Wow.
You're cool with a paper cut, sir?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
He'll do it.
No problem.
Ow. Who knows how to do a paper cut?
For anything. Don't you just got to, swipe it up?
Ow!
What if he does it to himself?
I think it would be hard to paper cut yourself.
Yeah. He would be doing it under duress.
All right, we'll figure out how we're doing the paper cut thing. Let me know when Egghead fucking responds to your response.
Oh, wow.
That just seems painful.
Ew, some guy tweeted a picture of your toes. Some guy tweeted a picture of all five of his horrible feet webbed.
All of them, huh, Jim?
Oh, my God.
Damn.
His toes look like Vicky LaMotta, the fucking after Jake beat her.
I guess I need to explain when.
Yeah.
When else would they have?
Well, are we through?
I don't know.
E-Rock, are we okay? Oh, you just got an answer?
Oh, shit.
Sorry.
Well, we don't cause injury to interns, even minor things like this.
Oh,
so
we
now
don't.
He's
this wee shit.
So,
who's
I'm,
this wee
I'm taking
shit?
That as a no.
He sucks. God, go away.
Oh,
please.
Boy. We don't.
That'll be part of the negotiation.
We
I
do.
Guarantee you.
Is that right?
Yes.
We
Egghead
do.
Needs to go if we continue.
Wow.
Fuck him. Piece of shit. Just a stupid paper cut, you idiot. Go program a dumb who gives a fuck music channel.
It could get infected.
Can you imagine?
And
we're down to not allowing paper cuts.
Paper cut. That's
people,
assault, brother.
Huh?
That's assault, brother.
E-Rock, name five things we used to do on the show that go way beyond paper cuts, please.
Care?
Yeah. Have fun, enjoy, smile, and laugh.
Oh, I can name one.
You can name one?
Yeah.
Anyone in the room.
Icy hot. On our balls.
Icy hot on the balls.
Interns. Stings.
Interns balls.
Did
any of you guys sue us or have a problem with that?
I had a problem with it, but...
But you didn't sue or nothing?
Duty hat.
Cinnamon challenge.
Cinnamon challenge. Oh,
yeah. I want intern with whole shit.
Bee stings. On the ball bag.
On the ball bag.
What?
Hiding thing. Staple gun.
Staple gun.
Hiding things up your ass.
Dog shit toothbrushing.
Dog shit toothbrush.
Eggnog
ding.
Challenge.
Number one answer. Dog shit toothbrush.
Bottle rocket
and now
pussy.
Now what we can do is have the intern juggle like balloons.
Yeah.
Like, look, bounce these two blue balloons and see which one falls first, then we'll all have a contest.
But if it pops, you might get frightened.
That's a good
so
point.
We can't have that.
That's true. He has to wear soft gloves, balloon-safe gloves.
Yeah.
And now we're debating if we could paper cut a guy. This is why I bring it up. This is why. Because I know there's a lot of cool shit we can still be
a
doing with this radio
cut.
Show. Not,
we should have started high and aimed low. Like what we should have done is said, look, we have an intern, and we want to put two Crystal Geyser water bottles in his asshole back to back. Can we do that? Go, no. All right, how about we paper cut his toes? All right, that's fine. We keep the bottles out of his asshole. We can't have that. We messed up.
I truly believe a mere 5 years ago, not only would we have done this without asking permission, we would have taken a chisel and a hammer.
Yeah, yeah. And just like fucking bang, bang.
One big
bang. Split that shit.
Yep.
You would have been yelling for Mars. Mars, do you have a hacksaw in there?
Got a hacksaw. Or not even, don't use anything. Just tear them apart like you're putting you're ripping a chicken wing off of a chicken. Just.
Yeah. We would ask Mars for a hacksaw and he'd bring in two spoons.
Boom. Oh, I thought this was what you asked.
Danny?
I don't know if it was mentioned yet. I might have been while I was walking down, but do you remember when Pat Duffy took a staple gun about a half inch into his forehead?
Yeah.
All right.
That happened.
That's a biggie.
Do you respect Egghead? So far, Sam has said no.
I didn't say E-Rock. No. I said I wasn't scared.
Look at the fear.
You don't respect him.
Well, he's
you respect what he's done in this business?
He's
You've done more.
It's like Heinrich Himmler walking around.
Crazy?
He's scaring everybody.
I'm not scared of him.
Easy.
Yeah. I didn't say I didn't respect him. That's a little bit, that's like personally insulting him. I don't want to insult the guy, but I would like it to be on the record. I'm not scared of him.
But for the radio show, you're allowed to say whatever you want.
Right.
Oh, what a set of balls. Yeah, look, I'm not saying that, but I'm not scared of him. But look, I'm not saying that.
Well, I don't
out of fear.
Insult a human being. So that's just rude.
You would insult him.
My entire career, I've said to these idiots, oh, man, that was just for the air.
Yeah.
That's, you know.
Just a little thing. Just
a little thing for the air.
The guys need me to get edgy.
And then every one of these dopes, okay. I'm like, it was that easy?
They haven't figured out that the honest part is the air part and the lying part is off the air.
Of course.
Isn't that what you tell Eric?
But Danny brings up good points. Staple gun. I don't know how far that went into his fucking.
That was a big one.
Temple.
It was bad enough where there was.
It was stuck.
Visits.
Remember, we couldn't get it out.
Yeah, dude.
Oh man, that's right.
It was in the bone.
I mean, Lana was psyched about it.
In hindsight, yeah, we probably shouldn't have done that.
Wait, that he did have to go to the hospital for that one, right?
But it happened. Then it was
right
fine.
On. That's
he had
cool.
To get a tetanus shot.
That's awesome.
See, that was
I don't condone
him.
That kind of
but
activity.
But fast forward a few years, now we can't paper cut people.
Ah, what a load.
There was a big difference in that there were no emails sent saying, do you mind if our intern takes an industrial strength staple gun and slams it into his forehead?
Right.
That was a good gun, man. That was like a brand new staple gun. That'd be.
I remember that.
High spring tension.
And I remember we tried to pull it out. We couldn't. Holy fuck.
And then we were scared that it was like we were going to pull out part of his brain when it came out.
We think it was way in.
We had to take a wire cutters and cut the staple and then pull out each side of it.
Yeah.
Because it bent outwards when it hit his skull.
That's right.
Holy shit! I forgot about that. Wow, we are idiots.
Never had a problem, though.
Wow.
Never had a real problem.
Oh, man.
Although.
Nothing we couldn't take care of on our own.
Although, if any one of those things had gotten us fired, that would have been the new Sex for Sam. Like, Sex for Sam is one of those things where if we had just not done that one part, we'd be going, look, we did this, we did Sex for Sam, we did that, that's all.
Yeah.
You never know that one's the fucking end until it's the end.
But could you imagine if you had Sex for Sam and then you were like, obviously we shouldn't have paper-cutted our intern's toes. Come on. What were we thinking?
Nyko Brown on the Twitter, N-I-K-O Brown. So the same people who did the infamous Baby Bird video can't do a fucking paper cut to an intern.
Nah.
That's why I bring this up. You're right. Yes, we cannot do that now.
Someone Someone like Pat Duffy would just go, what's the problem? Grab the envelope out of someone's hand and just start slicing himself with it. Yeah, he would have done that. But, then again, he didn't have E-Rock there to probably pounce on him.
E-Rock.
Drop the envelope. Drop it!
E-Rock, more like cock block.
The supervisor.
Damn.
E-Rock sees himself running this place someday.
Supervisor.
He has his eyes on the fucking boss's chair.
Oh, yeah.
Fucking narc.
You want to be a boss, huh?
Uh-oh, oh, he's shaking his head. I ain't no suit.
I ain't no suit.
Do they make WWE ties?
Oh.
Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh. Ooh.
What kind of boss?
Talking to the supervisor of the show like that?
Oh, no.
Cake boss.
Cake boss.
Man. Yeah. You don't respect E-Rock, that's for sure.
No, none so respect.
What happens now with Egghead? He tries to put a little more fear in your heads today?
Mission accomplished.
Don't respect that guy whatsoever. He's going to hold all of you back. I'm telling you. When we're long gone, don't respect that fucking guy. He stinks.
Right, and by that he means in October.
He stinks and just holds people back. That's his whole job.
When we're gone and he's still your boss as he is now.
Yes.
God, that's so sad that he would be.
E-Rock has his eye on the boss's chair.
Yeah,
he's like, I'm going to break that someday.
He's like, oh, joke. It was good, though.
He's just too heavy for it.
Sam.
I got it.
No. Oh, man.
That's too bad.
That is too bad.
This was supposed to be something pretty exciting. Now we
different
can't paper
from regular
people.
Radio.
Yeah.
Free from, you know, not free from crazy, crazy stuff, but... pretty wild.
It's too bad.
That's what I was under the impression.
Really is too bad.
Thanks, E-Rock, for
nothing. There would absolutely not be an issue with paper cutting this kid's web toes.
No.
And it's just too bad that we can't do it.
What's the story that goes right after the paper cut that's bad? You know, what is he imagining happens? Right after that paper cut.
He's like a freak of nature, and his femoral artery goes right down into
right
his toes.
Right through the toes, yeah. And he just fucking bleeds out on the floor because of a paper cut. Okay, that could happen.
His lifeblood he loses through his toes.
Yes.
Like, his life begins and ends with those fucking web disasters.
Although funny, Danny, that's exactly how they think.
What's that? I'm sorry.
I said, although funny, that's exactly how they
think. Hey, well, you know, if there's a 0.0001 chance of that happening, that's the part that they're concerned about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I can't even enjoy my egg whites now because they look like your toast. They really fucking bother me.
All right, we'll break and figure out the paper cut thing. Got some home run calls for the people out there.
And is the new boss okay with what we did so far?
So far, so good.
All right.
I'm eating.
Mr. Big Shot.
Mr. Big Shot.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
How was your weekend, Anthony?
Wunderbar.
Do anything exciting?
No, just relax.
Nah.
Fucking relaxed.
Nothing
nice.
Wrong with relaxing.
I know. Just relaxed. I did watch, I love that show, fucking Locked Up Abroad.
Suits?
No. Well. Watch Locked Up Abroad.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they're usually really good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the people, and it's their story of getting locked up, abroad.
Mm-hmm.
And it's usually some kind of coke or smuggling back a bunch of heroin or weed or something like that. Last time I watched, it sounded interesting. This guy is a male nurse, and he tends to be gay, and he needs some money, so he sees an ad. It's like, be a nurse here at this hospital in Saudi Arabia.
Whoa.
And make some cash. And he's like, all right, I'll do that. And then he reads the rules, and it's like, gay in Saudi Arabia, punishable by execution. So he's like, what do I do? And then he's thinking, I'll just be celibate for like a year that I'm there. And, that didn't last very long. That guy needed the cock. Needed the cock. So he gets a friend of his that says he's got this program that'll keep the Saudis from looking at your internet searches because you want to search, you know, the gay sites.
You want to search the gay.
Yeah, and he got some gay. He had some gay. And then...
How was the gay?
I guess he enjoyed it.
He enjoyed the gay.
He enjoyed that gay.
Mm-hmm.
Then he wanted some more gay.
Oh, boy.
So he got a little more gay, and that one didn't work out very well.
Why didn't that gay work out?
Well, it worked out first. They had some sex, some gay. And then he got a text from the guy, like, a couple of months later saying, meet me at the coffee shop. And it's like, could you get alcohol? Because alcohol also in Saudi Arabia. No.
What is wrong with this guy?
So the guy just said, he goes, I'll meet you at the coffee shop. Didn't say yes or anything like that. He goes, I'll meet you. But he put a little X, like kiss thing. And as he's walking to the coffee shop, the Saudi religious police that roam around.
They have religious police?
Yeah, there's virtue police over there. And they grabbed the guy and fucking threw him beating and dragged him off to jail.
But, wow.
And then they drag him into this room, and they give him this piece of paper that's written all in Arabic and tell him to sign it. He says, no, that didn't last long. Well, boy, whenever they tell you to sign something, you're like, no.
You might as well sign it.
It's like 5 minutes later, they're just signing away anything. Whatever you need.
Was he an American?
No, he's a Brit.
Okay.
Well, you're signing away with a swollen eye.
Yeah, a big swollen eye. Your fucking testicles are huge.
Your hand's all bruised, but you're still Travis. Able to sign.
Yeah. Then they come up to him and go, well, you can go home now. And he gets out, and he goes back to his hotel room, or his compound, wherever he's staying in Saudi Arabia. But he wants to get out really bad, because he's not sure why they even let him out. You know, he signed what he thought was a confession for being the gay, and it's punishable by execution. So he's like, I don't know what the hell's going on. I got to get out of here. But then Saudi Arabia, also, they take your passport when you get there, and you need permission to leave. You can't just leave Saudi Arabia. You got to say... and you got to go through the police to make sure you don't have a record that you haven't been arrested for something and you're trying to flee.
That's scary.
So that's what this guy had to do.
Right.
He actually had to say, go to the police, give fingerprints, and then 10 days later, he went back and he was all scared. And the guy goes, no, you don't have any record or anything. So he doesn't even know what happened with the gay charge.
What a shitty country.
And then it was horrible. But the episode itself... A lot more like, what's going to happen than happen. I mean, I've seen some of those where they're in for years and getting beaten. So, this guy spent the afternoon in jail.
Oh, they're running out of stories is what's happening.
I think so.
He didn't realize here. It was kilometers an hour, not miles per hour, and he got stopped for a ticket.
What about his time in the gay prison? Was it a prison for the gay?
No, it was just a Saudi jail. You know, and they put him in there, and...
Nothing happened to him in there?
No.
How long was he in jail?
Wow, this...
Not long at all.
Oh, God, the show has jumped the shark. Huh?
I think what they did, though, they did this story to show how fucked up Saudi Arabia is with gays. They really don't like the gay.
You would assume they didn't like the gay, though, right?
Oh, yeah, with that Muslim law, the virtue police.
What's the virtue
police? They're these guys, these elders, and they roam around with, like...
How bad do they want to be gay?
Oh, yeah, of course.
If that's your job, you're searching out gay, guess what? I think you want some of the gay.
Yeah. They go around, but it's not just the gay. They're not the gay police. They're the virtue police. So they go around, and they're these old guys, and they're wearing all the fucking religious garb and everything. And they got these staffs, these big fucking wooden staffs that they walk around with. And then they'll just smack a woman over the fucking head because her veil isn't up high enough. Or her fucking eyebrows are showing. And they'll just smack them. And then the fucking women are like, and they
terrible
freak out.
Culture. What a horrible way to live. Terrible culture.
And we do business with them as a country. And it's like, you know, and we have the gall to talk about other countries' human rights records.
It's sickening.
When we do business with these fucking savage animals.
It's amazing how we criticize every country, we tell them how to act, and then our fucking presidents hold hands like douchebags walking with these guys.
And
it's
how
fucking
about
embarrassing.
How about people being persecuted here for saying they don't like gay marriage? Which, you know, I could give a shit. I get married, who cares? But people like literally blackballed here for saying that I don't agree with the gay marriage thing, I'm religious, whatever. Meanwhile, the country itself is doing business with a fucking country that kills gay people because they're gay and doesn't speak out about it. Doesn't say, like, you know, but they'll speak out about it here. Say, oh,
are you saying
terrible.
It's hypocritical?
Yes, just a tad hippie-critical.
Of course.
And I would be happy if we cut all ties with Saudi Arabia.
Yes.
All fucking ties and stop protecting them.
Yeah.
We should pull all protection and let any country in the Middle East that wants to just walk in and kick the shit out of them do it.
I'm sure there's a reason why we can't do it.
They own too much of the U.S.
Nah.
And oil.
Yeah, they do.
A lot of their money here.
Rumor has it they own the U.S. at this point.
I thought that was the Chinese.
Thank you very much for bringing me something to the intern. Are you aware that you're in studio and on the air?
Oh, shit. Iraq.
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 Oh, no, the mic's off. Hold on. Off mic.
Oh, no, we talked into an off mic. No. Iraq, we humiliated the intern by having him talking to an off mic. Is he okay?
Oh, no.
I think he's fine.
Is this based on something you heard after the mics went off, Jimmy?
I did not, no.
Oh, okay.
I'm just making sure that you understand that you weren't here bringing me a beverage and a sandwich.
Yes. Yes, I was.
You knew that?
I thought so. I mean,
you are on the air right now.
Okay.
Okay.
I guess all hell broke loose over our other intern bit from last week.
Did it really?
That innocent dumb bit we did. It was a dumb throwaway bit, and I heard all hell broke loose.
The intern
is that what you're getting at, Jimmy?
Yeah, I guess I really wasn't, but I do remember hearing that now. When the other intern walked in, I gave him shit. I was joking.
Yeah, we were kidding with him.
I was like, "What the fuck? Put this down here!" And then I did it at one point where I actually laughed.
Yeah.
It was so dumb.
Yeah.
Well, Egghead didn't realize how dumb it was.
Oh, no.
And it was a big issue last week, wasn't it, E-Rock? Look at E-Rock.
E-Rock, what was the issue?
He's scared.
E-Rock, what was the issue?
Why is everyone scared around here?
You got to tell us, E-Rock. We don't read minds. All right.
Even when we were making no money, we weren't scared like you guys are.
Intern leaving studio in one piece. Intern leaving studio in one piece. E-Rock?
All basically, Jimmy went after the intern last week. It was all in fun and joking,
joke, yeah.
And then we made him go down the hall and get like a cold soda. And then
40 degrees.
And then we
40 degrees. We told.
And
him
then
that.
We listened in as E-Rock kind of scolded and I was going to say berate, but I don't
he didn't
know
even berate. He made him sit in the corner and think about what he's done.
Yeah,
and
think about what you've
it
done.
Was a good throwaway bit. It wasn't like oh my god radio, but it was good. People enjoyed it.
Sure.
And then I guess after we went home, there were discussions and. Sit downs and
all kinds of shit.
All kinds of shit that E-Rock, I guess, doesn't want to talk about.
What happened, E-Rock? We need to know because we have to.
He's shaking his head now. Let the record state he's shaking the head. Let the record also state that E-Rock's in a very bad position right now.
Oh, yeah.
We understand that.
And he's got his palm firmly planted on
E-Rock,
his face.
You don't need that gig anyway. You don't need to be the supervisor of interns, so don't worry about it. They'll give it to somebody else.
Who is the intern, E-Rock, that did it? What was his name?
On Friday, that was Kevin.
Is he here?
Yeah, he's doing a food run right now.
Okay, when he's back, let's have him come in.
So what happened, E-Rock, after the show Friday?
You had lunch, no. And then what happened at 6 p.m.?
Lunch at 6 p.m.
Long lunch.
What happened, E-Rock? Just hours. Talk. You don't need to be supervising those guys anyway. Let them figure something else out.
Well,
you actually had a sit-down meeting with him? You had to discuss it?
We had a discussion.
Oh, wow. With discussion.
What was the discussion about?
Now let the record state that Anthony's shaking his head wildly.
I'm stunned.
It's unbelievable. It was a dumb throwaway bit.
Just fucking around.
It was whatever.
Just fucking around.
You had to
fun.
Sit in an office with him and talk about it?
Unbelievable.
What was the discussion about? We're asking you, so you have to say. We're your bosses too, believe it or not.
We discussed the segment in which the intern was sternly talked to.
Ooh.
And then maybe reprimanded afterwards for his actions in studio.
Yeah, it was all a bit, which the intern was aware of immediately after the bit right. was concluded.
Yeah.
So what's the problem?
But on the air, it doesn't sound like that.
Well, it's not. That's the beauty of the bit on the air.
Yeah, it's called.
That's why it's a bit.
Supposed to explain it first.
Right.
And
when Anthony does an impression, should we say, "No, this is not really Ronald Reagan in the room"?
Yes. Hello.
Reagan was just in here.
I know. Right?
This is the same dope, by the way. I want to remind the audience that said, "Good news, guys! You could do the homeless shopping spree, but we're going to tell them all you're coming."
And they have to sign
not
a
understanding what the whole bit was about.
Yeah, they want the mall to sign a waiver,
right.
Releasing this company and probably indemnifying them.
Right, indemnify us.
Good news. As long as we tell them and they sign all the legal
documents, and we have to adhere to the rules of the mall and.
And I rolled my eyes, and I remember, like it was yesterday, I said, "You're an idiot."
I actually liked some of the workarounds that they had.
The empty warehouse?
We could just set up a warehouse and put, like, things that they could just pick up.
It was a
Costco.
A Costco.
Right. Right,
go to a Costco before it opens,
and that wasn't his idea. To be fair, that was
it was one of Howard Stern's lackeys.
Nope. Was it?
I'm all in today. Fuck it.
Ask me anything.
What do you mean one of his lackeys?
I'll opinions all day long.
He was just kind of... Who was it? What'd you say it?
It's a guy that's best friends with Howard and also has to work with us, so it's a conflict of interest.
Now, let me ask you. Here's what I think is going on behind the scenes. I think all the bosses want to fuck E-Rock, and they just like getting him in the office to check him out.
Yeah.
Like, they're probably very sensual discussions.
Chubby chasers.
Yeah, they're all chubby chasers. Like, they'll sit there and talk to E-Rock, that's totally unacceptable, and then they'll kind of, like, push their slacks forward with their hard-ons, and they'll go, so what are we going to do about this? No? Just a thought.
Just a thought. So there was a discussion that, what, the intern could have been in a situation on Friday?
Could have been in a situation. But it was just mostly, you know, we're just looking out for the well-being of the intern. For, you know, why they're here. This isn't the reasons why that they're here helping us out. And, you know, to make sure that they're being treated respectfully and they're learning and, and those kind of things.
Is that what interns are for?
No.
To learn and
radio was
be respected.
Radio, I mean, from the beginning, you did all sorts of crazy shit with interns. We did crazy shit with interns for how many years we've been doing this together? 18 or something?
Yeah.
Whoa. 18 years, and we've never, ever, ever had an issue with an intern to the point where it was going to get anyone in trouble.
No.
Had some situations, but it was easy to get out of. Very easy to get out of, actually.
Old fucking... throw the strawberry on the shoe guy.
Oh, yeah.
He was an issue.
He enraged me. Because he was a rich, spoiled kid. Yeah. Drove me nuts. And,
Julia.
He was a good kid, though.
Whoa.
So what was the problem? That we secretly recorded him, E-Rock?
Well, the reprimanding portion of the broadcast, where he was in here... it was brought up whether he knew or not that he was still on the air while we were having this discussion.
Holy shit.
And everything's fine. No, everything got talked out. Everything is
Here's
fine.
The bottom line them knowing they're on the air. They signed something.
Yes.
Whenever you are in this vicinity, you have to assume you're being recorded or on the air. They signed something that says that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's... Yeah, they have to be expected when they are here at all. When they come in... to do their internship, that anything they say and it will be used against them.
And the intern was aware, so, you know, that wasn't a problem.
E-Rock, you don't need the gig. Relax. Stop. Stop trying to protect your supervisor gig.
Is that a clip from the Tonys last night?
Blow it up.
It's Julia from Noah. I thought it was a clip from the Tony Awards.
Look at all those comments are disabled.
Hey, I wonder.
I don't know. It's probably a similar reason.
So is masculinity.
To the point where it has 69 likes and 536 dislikes.
Wow.
All right, we'll move on.
Well, you should check with E-Rock before you move on.
Are we all right, E-Rock?
I'm not your supervisor.
Who were you protecting right there? I heard that.
I have to protect the interns. Oh,
they're the innocent.
I'm hearing the sarcasm. Nice. There you go.
He's more, like the more of that, E-Rock. You're like the catcher in the rye. You're protecting.
Oh, catcher of the rye.
Catcher of the wheat. Ham on rye.
Oh, is that funny? Catcher of the ham and Swiss on rye.
Jesus. So what do you guys think of Madonna's tit? You see that?
Yeah.
It does reek of desperation.
Goes back to our point. This was yesterday... / Saturday night, I believe, and it's in today's paper. God, the papers are way behind. Madonna flashed her titty there?
She did a little tit flash. Is this the video that
Istanbul,
we're watching
Turkey.
Here? Istanbul, they should have fucking arrested her. What's she doing?
The audio's horrible, so we'll just lower that.
She's like taking her top
off. She's 53!
Bra thing. She's doing a little Madonna dance.
I have a problem with those arms. Those arms are way too manly. When she teases that she's going to pull her bra down, and then there she goes.
Ew. Oh, no. She showed a nipple.
There she goes. There's her nipple. Yeah. It's not bad.
No, it's fine, but who cares about it?
It's not bad.
You can see her twat in the old Playboy or penthouse,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's true.
That big, huge, over-the-top hairy bush of hers. Oh, my God. It's not bad. And she's not, I mean, she's done this her whole career to get people talking.
It's amazing. That
and her last album is not doing too well, so.
Oh, yeah, she's
no
trying
surprise
everything.
That she's trying to do something.
It's bombing.
Get
she's
people talking.
Trying everything.
Yeah.
Trying to make a little news, you know, doing the whole bash Gaga a little bit. Now she's pulling a tit out.
Mm-hmm. Lady Gaga got hit on the head.
Oh, yeah. Is that a great clip?
But it proves that she lip syncs her entire show. Did anyone else notice?
There wasn't a...
there was a stop.
There was?
No, yeah. There was not the clip I saw.
Yep.
Oh, shit.
She doesn't lip sync. I've seen her.
She doesn't lip sync.
She does not.
Don't you fucking get on Sam's bad side with Lady Gaga.
I forgot.
Somebody cracked over the head with a pole.
What is that? That's not lip sync.
I might have to apologize. Let's see. Big, heavy. I mean, she got hit hard.
You hear that? Is the was not saying.
How did she go right back to singing?
Are you sure she's not singing over a track?
She doesn't lip sync.
How do you get hit in the head that hard?
Because
and
the lyrics are missing.
I really want to see this live now, this song. That made me want to hear Judas.
Yeah, it's a good song.
Don't you love Lady Gaga?
She's Jimmy, the best.
Jimmy.
And the lyrics are missing.
A Gaga fan.
If she was singing over a track, you would hear, Judas is the demon I cling to.
Yes, it absolutely did stop. And there's no way someone is monitoring so closely that they dropped the lyrics and then saw her lips and put them back. You couldn't have timed that.
True. Maybe she's making more of a deal out of this. Maybe that object wasn't that heavy.
I think that's more. I don't think she's got any concussion.
That looked pretty fucking.
Okay.
That looked pretty bad, though.
Yeah, but
like
if it's a prop, maybe it's not heavy.
I think that's what she's not being.
And now she's
about.
Taking advantage of the fact that it looked like she got hurt.
That I'll agree.
Maybe it hit her enough to throw off for a split second.
Like it's a surprise, but I don't think she got any concussion from that. She didn't even.
Let me see it again.
It is pretty fucking.
Because the guy.
What is it? A big pole?
Yeah.
What is it, Sam? Yeah.
It's a pole from her set.
I bet that guy got fired.
If you get hit, if that object is hard, man, you're not gonna pause for a split second and continue singing.
What was it used for earlier, though? Like, why was he moving it in the middle of the song? He was part of the show.
Mm-hmm.
So what was happening before that the purpose was to move it? Like, what was it? Was she swinging on it like it was a pole? Like, what is it? I said, what is it, 8 times? We get it. We don't know.
Some kind of a pole. She got a pole.
I know.
That's a very high adrenaline show. That adrenaline fuels you through a lot.
That is true. You get done, and you're like, ow, that hurt.
Yeah.
Meow.
I want to see the show, don't you?
Yeah, really. The last tour was amazing.
We'll go when she comes.
Oh, I can't wait. We should go together.
I will.
Okay, great.
I would go.
I would check it out. She's unbelievable.
Some of that shit's catchy. I'm not downloading it or any of that.
You should.
There's some catchy shit there.
I went to the Monsters Ball.
I did
as well.
Yeah. It was fun, right?
Yeah. I just don't like on Twitter where she talks to her little monsters, but I'm not the guy she's talking to.
You don't like the little monsters?
You want to be a little monster, don't you?
Yes, I do.
You want to be acknowledged as a little monster?
Yes, I do.
It would make your day. Yes,
oh, my God. Jimmy is a little monster.
I'm a little monster.
What's a little monster mean?
That's all we had on Madonna?
Well, she's, she's talking to, 15 or 14-year-old, transgendered weird kids. Then, they're not, she's not talking to us fucking jaded, almost 50-year-old men creeps. She's talking to young, we're like, monsters, what the fuck?
What is that? All right, she's talking to the children.
Yeah, like, they think they're little monsters. Hi, I'm a monster, are you sure? We'll go to Monsters, Inc. together. What do I know?
That's all we had on Madonna? There's nothing else there, I guess.
She flashed her tit and turkey.
Yeah.
She just can't deal with the fact that she's finished.
Oh,
she's still selling out, though.
She does,
but she's always going to sell. I mean, a lot of people sell out, but she's not like a.
What's wrong with her music? It's just not catchy?
She's 53 years old. Like,
but is it too complicated, her music? What's going on there?
No, it's just people have heard Madonna. Like, they're ready for the next thing. Yeah. You can't do this.
She stayed relevant much longer than most people who do what she does.
30 years, I would
say.
Much
longer. Yeah, dude.
She made 30 years, I think.
She was, I hate to say trend-setting, but she was, dictating all this stuff in pop culture for 30 fucking years.
Wow.
It's amazing to pull that off. Like, P. Diddy or Puff, whatever, does it for a short period of time.
Right.
But she was doing it for since the 80s.
Yeah. She's all done now.
But she's selling out all around the world. How's she done?
But she can still sell out and do shows, but she's not...
Maybe she shouldn't put that album out.
Like, her fans are her fans.
Sam has proclaimed it.
She's not getting new fans anymore.
She should sing... I think she should sing stuff that's more... Whatever. I would like to hear her sing different stuff. Like, I don't really want to hear Madonna doing pop music anymore. It doesn't
she
interest
me.
She
tried all that shit, though, didn't she?
Some of that Evita shit.
That Evita shit.
Which I liked.
Yeah.
You don't want to hear her sing her old pop song?
I don't mind them, but the new ones don't do much for me. Like, she's not going to write a pop song, a new pop song,
right,
better than fucking Judas.
What about La Isla Bonita?
I love La Isla Bonita is a good one. Who doesn't?
Right. But she shouldn't be putting out new pop songs.
I like that song, though. The fucking island. It's beautiful.
Can we talk about Don Rickles? Unfortunately,
I don't like him. I don't go for that type of
stuff. Oh, that type of humor.
Unfortunately, no one in the media will explain Don Rickles to their viewers. Don Rickles has been doing offensive humor for his entire career. He don't give a fuck about PC crap. Never has and never will. I guess he made an... Oh, you found words similar?
Not the exact joke, but definitely...
This is what I was telling these guys, material. But we all know this. Don Rickles has been making racist jokes his entire career.
Yeah, that's what he does.
Entire career. So he made an Obama joke. What was the Obama joke? Do we have the actual audio of that?
I don't know if there is audio. I just saw transcripts of it.
What was the exact joke?
I have black friends. I shouldn't make fun of the blacks. President Obama's a friend of mine. He was over the house the other day, but the mop broke or something like that. Yeah. He was implying that Obama's a janitor, and it made me laugh.
That's hilarious. And the fact is, this is Don Rickles. He hasn't changed his act. He's been doing this forever, but for some reason, the media doesn't want to point this out.
Yeah.
We're part of the media, I know. Because every time I say that,
we're pointing
it
out.
You're part of the media.
Mainstream media.
Yeah, the mainstream guys.
Point it out like that?
Media. Yeah, that don't say cunt. The guys that don't pepper their news with cunt.
Yeah.
Those guys. They're like, oh my God, Don Rickles, what happened? He lost his fucking mind.
What is he talking
about,
Obama?
Oh, look at this. Look at this clip. Oh, we got the transcript. He's losing his fucking mind. Sam found this from the Sammy Davis Jr. roast, right?
Sammy.
Yeah,
Sammy.
It's racial.
What year is this?
70...
Whatever.
I'm going to guess 76.
Yeah, it doesn't
probably even lower.
It looks like
probably
it.
Early 70s.
From one of the old Dean Martin roasts.
Yeah. Right.
No, you're Catholic and I'm a Jew, and Sammy, you're black.
I'm sorry. Jesus.
He said, Sammy, you're black, you suck?
No.
I'm sorry.
He said,
I'm sorry.
So-and-so, you're a Catholic, I'm a Jew, Sammy, you're black. I'm sorry.
That's brilliant.
Can you hear that again?
Yeah, the audio was a little rough for me.
Yeah, I love it.
He's great.
No, you're Catholic and I'm a Jew, and Sammy, you're black.
I'm sorry.
Sup.
Remember the words of a great Negro. I say that honestly. All peoples are alike. We are all working. You live in my neighborhood. I live in yours. Right, Sam?
Right.
Are you crazy?
Nipsey Russell.
Nipsey Russell.
Freddie Prinze. Wow, this is old.
That doesn't matter. It's in your heart, right, Sam? Be proud. Brothers, we kiss, we hug. Any black on my lips?
Oh, my God.
Kiss them.
That's what he focuses on.
Huh?
Yeah, I bet Don Rickles really hates black people.
And he's just been getting away with it for 50,
he's
60
like, this
years.
Is what a great gimmick I have. Right. People adore me for this.
Right. I saw him in, me and Florentine went and
God,
saw
I want to see him.
In Vegas, because he was doing the early show, and we were doing the late show with Dice at the Stardust. And there was one really funny line where a black guy comes out on stage. He's obviously in the show. And as soon as he walks out on stage, Rickles goes, problem with the bags?
Oh, God.
He's a porter. He's a funny dude, man. And his timing. I've seen that line before. I'm a Jew. You're black. I'm sorry. But with the timing of that, sorry.
Yeah.
And he hasn't really written any new material. He's been doing the same stuff for a long time because it works. The headline, though, Don Rickles shocks Hollywood crowd with racial Obama joke.
Ugh, who cares?
Way to not know what Don Rickles is about.
I know.
So
I made fun of Obama for being black in 2008. It's not a big shocking deal. I just threw myself into the story. Who cares?
Is there anything going on with this thing? Are they asking for an apology? What's happening?
No.
I don't think so, no. They just need something to write about. There's nothing else. He shocks a Hollywood crowd. Give us a fuck.
Did he?
By doing what? Something new and interesting?
Right. Yeah.
How do you shock a Hollywood crowd? We got it, Jim.
Just trying to see if there's anything more to this.
Nah, I think it was
Rickles actually said something.
Don Rickles nearly hijacked the American Film Institute tribute to Shirley MacLaine on Thursday night in Sony Pictures Studios, at Sony Pictures Studios, unleashing a trademark barrage of insults that took aim at President Obama. I shouldn't make fun of the blacks, Rickles said, and then proceeded to do just that. Oh, okay. President Obama is a personal friend of mine. He was over at the house yesterday, but the mob broke. Okay, he's not apologizing.
No.
He was just setting up his...
yeah. His... Oh, God, I would hope not. If Rickles apologizes, God, we're all finished.
Scared me for a second.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Right.
Yeah, he doesn't have to apologize. He's not, and I don't even think the industry would call for it.
No, never.
It's one of those things where he's like, he's separate. Other comic, if another comic got up there, a younger comic, and said something like that,
he'd be fucked.
There'd be a problem.
He would be fucked, right?
Definitely, there would be a problem.
It very frustrates me though that this is even talked about by the public. I don't get it.
Right. Yeah.
It's humor.
It's just changing. Things are just changing.
Humor.
It's humor. You think stupid Reverend Al will get involved?
No.
No.
Don Rickles?
He wouldn't touch this.
He would seem to, because
but
he would seem like
if it was
like
young
a
comic
dummy.
That had a spot on some big show, he would.
Yeah, yeah, then it would be.
Right?
Definitely. It would be, you know, Obama made something of himself and unfunny, yeah.
You know what? Sharpton would address something like that. He would say, just because he's an older Don Rickles, that doesn't mean he should not have to live by the same rules of decency as the rest of society.
I could see him saying anything ridiculous like that, so you're right. Yeah.
Mm.
I don't know. He won't apologize. He doesn't have to.
I hope not.
They'll never ask him to.
That's just humor, man.
Yeah, but it doesn't have to be that. I just think that's a little bit unnecessary.
All right.
Oh, it's the Black Roland.
Yeah. And his name is Roland.
Yeah.
He skated. He was in trouble.
He's on CNN.
Oh, you're right.
They're bringing Roland Martin back, huh? Good. I forgot what he did.
The tweets about...
what did he do wrong?
Oh, didn't he do the David Beckham underwear tweets during the Super Bowl?
Oh, yeah. Yes. So he was sort of making some...
Oh, right.
He was trying for some gay humor.
Was he gay bashing?
Well, that's what they try to make it into, but he was just fucking doing some guy slash gay slash
that's gay bashing
humor. So they had to sit him out for a while.
And how
looks like they're bringing him back?
How come you turn on the Tony Awards? You know, if you're gay, I didn't, but I heard about it.
Are you sure you didn't turn them on?
Of course you didn't. No, no, I was watching Titanic. How come you turn that on and all they do is make gay Broadway jokes?
They're allowed
amongst
to,
themselves.
They're gay.
But if you make a gay Broadway joke, then you're stereotyping.
Isn't that the dumbest
Broadway
rule ever?
It makes no sense.
Because
they apparently love it because they're always making gay jokes.
Blacks can make fun of blacks.
Yeah.
Gays can make fun of gays. But if you're straight, you can't make fun of gays. If
right.
you're white, you can't make fun of blacks.
No.
It's really confusing.
Right.
But if a black guy makes fun of whites, we don't go yelling and screaming.
Yeah.
Because why?
I don't know.
We're powerful or something?
Well, right to the ruling class.
Forget about the jokes. Apparently, blacks can just go around shooting each other, too, with no real comment coming from anybody. But and for nothing but pure criminal reasons. But then you get, like, a Hispanic guy that they want to be white shoots a black guy in what appears to be self-defense. And that's a big issue. Meanwhile, you know. What happened over at that pool party shooting incident over the weekend?
Where? I don't even know.
Some black guy shot like three students.
Why?
A pool party. Oh, well, they had a little argument.
What town?
Auburn. Let's see. Yeah, there it is. And there's your suspect. All right.
Is he arrested in jail?
No, they're looking for him, I think, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's over, you know, just again. Just put the fucking guns away. Could you just stop? What are you doing? And there it is. You know, there was an altercation. And instead of... still got a little cough. Chatting it out. or fisticuffs. The guns got to come out. So,
Be funny if you were trying to grab a hit. Like, you were trying to follow up bowling for behave, but you just kept throwing out stuff that didn't work.
Oh, yeah. You know, come on. Lighten up.
Cut the bunk. No.
Stop the malarkey.
Yeah. Why don't you quit it? Like you started talking in the song cadence.
Oh, how embarrassing.
Why don't you just stop?
Put the guns away.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Why don't you do that? And tried to make it like lyrically more responsible and better.
Fails miserably.
Yeah, it's a dud.
Yeah, this so many of these double standards like that though.
Oh, there's a lot.
Yeah,
it's kind of dumb.
The gay though with the Tony Awards. Were, yeah, that's.
Well, we got the.
They love the gay jokes.
We got the opening number.
Oh, a number.
You want to count? Are there actual gay jokes in here? I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't think so. This is more theater.
Oh, we don't have to play this, do we?
Well, I mean, it might just bring us up a little bit, bring the energy up.
I like hearing it, yeah.
Neil Patrick Harris, MPH.
What if life were more like theater?
Oh, well.
What if
we'd all not be able to sit? Went,
you heard a band.
Who's singing this?
Neil Patrick Harris.
What if life was so much sweeter if you could cue the weather with your hands?
Cool.
And what if all your questions had rhyming answers and you never left home without...
I can't listen to this.
This is so gay.
But it's good, though.
It just reminds me why I don't go
to Broadway. Neil Patrick Harris is very Broadway.
Life would be fun if... Imagine, Broadway. But can you imagine controlling the weather with your hand?
Oh, it'd be great.
Or there's a band everywhere you walk in?
Yes.
Ah, da, 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 like that scene in The Godfather.
Control the weather with your fist. Make a mudslide. That's just always bad. It's always just terrible, isn't it, Jim?
Oh, that was fucking brilliant. You fish.
Jesus.
Oh, that was fucking hot.
So you don't like the the jolly Broadway musical? No.
But your backup dancers. What if life were more like theater? Wouldn't life be grand? What if life were tightly written and divided?
Why are we listening to this?
Make a mutt.
It's just... It was jolly. It was a happy opening number.
It's definitely happy.
Yeah. Man, that Neil Patrick Harris coming out of the closet was like the best thing he ever did.
Who was he before? Like, what did he do before?
Doogie Howser.
Doogie Howser.
Is that who that is?
Boy Doctor.
You didn't know
that
was Doogie Howser?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the
Doogie Howser kid.
And now he's on How I Met Your Mother.
Yeah. And he's like the sweetheart of the gay community.
They love him.
Everyone loves him. He does the Tony Awards like this, and it's great. He makes the gay jokes.
And he plays a womanizer on How I Met Your Mother, so he has that.
So he's a great actor.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he's, and before he came out of the closet, really.
He was just Doogie.
It was Doogie. Now he's actually, I think he transcended the Duke.
He's NPH now.
Yes.
Now he's Doogie has, Doogie House him. Is it House or get it? Boo.
Get into nifty little
wait,
scenes.
Wait. Now he's Doogie Howser.
Doogie Howser. Doogie Howser.
Doogie.
Oh, my God. Oh, my whole world.
The world's a pretty big place, Amanda.
What's it supposed to mean?
It means I'm leaving you.
No.
Oh.
Mamma mia.
And just as you were split, your apartment disappeared by unknown means. Thanks, mysterious people in black clothing.
Just as you were splitting.
You pull your cock out and your friends start shitting. Can't help it. It's just right there.
Of course. You can't say splitting to us.
Exactly. Yes.
Dookie.
Can we hear more? This is marvelous.
Yeah, I love this. Look, and I'm watching the video. They're dancing. They're doing a dance number. The video sings.
Okay. Something strange about a magical 7-second costume change. And
and then
wow, that's pretty good.
Of nothing, there were crazy dance routines.
Ah, they're dancing. This is very Broadway.
Yeah, they're dancing up a storm,
really are.
And that's what I don't like about Broadway.
Everyone's diction were crisper. Secrets were told in a shouted whisper. And the only problems
this is like
that
a bunch of inside Broadway jokes.
Oh, yeah. Hey, you guys want to hear me sing about my problems?
Yeah!
I love my fake friends. What if everyone took it for granted?
Ooh, why
British
are they joking about?
Umbrellas were all enchanted.
That what was?
British umbrellas.
Wow.
Oh, it's Mary Poppins. Mary Poppins.
The fucking lady's flying.
Oh, it's okay, Chip.
It's on cable, Chip.
It's a show. Broadway show.
Fucking witchcraft.
Show.
I went to see that one time. I ran out of the theater. Fuck that shit. Fucking crazy. Turn it off.
It's a show. You idiot.
Thank God Gary doesn't work on Broadway. There would be no more flying Mary Poppins.
No, definitely not. Spider-Man would be S-O-L.
Oh, that's, fuck that. Yeah, it's much too
you
dang.
Wouldn't be able to do that on Broadway if Gary was in charge.
Think it's a good idea to have a person flying over the stage mm-hmm. with nothing but an umbrella to protect them from?
It's great.
Yeah.
Looks like fucking RFK's ex-wife flying seekers. She's on a rope. Fuck her. He said she used to beat him. That's what's coming out in the paper today. She used to hit him.
Yeah, she used to hit him.
She was a fucking monster, apparently.
Yeah.
And she killed a family pet, too.
Was that by accident, I'm guessing?
I don't think so.
Oh, no?
They're hinting that there might have been a little something there.
She was pretty, though. God damn. I take a punch from her.
They're calling it Neil Patrick Harris's charming Tony Awards opening number.
Yeah.
It's all just inside jokes on Broadway, like
shouting whisper.
Yeah, like only real hardcore. Well, I guess that's who's watching.
He's owning it and stuff. I mean, it doesn't suck.
Hey, I'm not saying the man isn't.
We're not his
talent.
Audience, but
he's a song and dance man now.
Oh yeah, and a doctor.
The Dookie, yes, and the youngest doctor ever.
Hit this, Mary Poppins.
And your next door neighbor was the legendary Patti LuPone.
Oh, Patti LuPone.
Hi, Patti.
It's Patti LuPone.
Who is she?
She was the original Evita on Broadway circa 1979, maybe.
I didn't know you're such a theater aficionado.
I know everything about the theater.
I really don't know that world at all. I just don't know that world.
You know Patti LuPone.
No, I didn't.
She's legendary. She's been in a shitload of stuff.
If she walked in here, I would just make fucking amazing rhymes about her name, and then that would be it. Hey, Patti LuPone, get on the phone. Place a crack up.
Related to Al Capone, Patti LuPone?
Yeah.
She was on that show with the retarded kid.
What?
Life Goes On.
Oh,
she
Corky.
Was the mother in Life Goes On with Corky.
Oh, wow, really?
I couldn't think of a fucking funny show to yell at about a retarded kid.
Oh, jeez. Wait. Yeah, yes, that would have been.
Yes.
Yeah. I didn't even think I was tonight. Setting something
yeah, the
up
Nagles,
there.
The Nagles, yeah.
The Nagles. That show, The Nagles. The young boy.
You want to continue with this?
I do. Yeah. She's pushing a lawnmower. Why?
All right.
Yeah, why is she pushing a lawnmower? Is that
because
an inside
she's
joke?
The neighbor.
Oh.
He set all it right. up. Said,
I don't pay attention to Broadway lyrics and what they're talking about.
You got to. It helps us move the story.
Oh, it's just a thing. I just know what Rum Tum Tugger said.
Oh, yeah.
Cats. Heard you talking about cats on your little show there you do after the show.
I like cats.
And, you've seen it?
Yeah. I've seen it a bunch of times.
Bunch of times. Now
where?
Forever at the Winter Garden Theater.
Yeah, when it was at the Winter Garden Theater, I started at the Winter Garden Theater.
They lied. It's not forever.
No, now it's Mamma
Now
Mia.
Until closing.
Yeah.
Now until
yeah. Was, now until June.
It seems like a dated 80s thing.
What was it about?
Nothing. Yeah, it wasn't about anything. It was just cats singing.
There was no real point
there was
to
no
the whole
story
thing?
To the whole
thing. Wasn't it loosely based on like T.S. Eliot?
I guess, but there was no sort of. I felt
no,
like
there wasn't
was
a story
no
to it.
No,
there
had
no
to be
story.
Some kind of story. What was the story?
No, like each cat had their own story.
Their
and
own
they
own
were,
story. It was they, a Monte. Yeah.
Yeah, the whole play was just each cat going up and telling their story.
About what? Being, a,
being
cat?
A cat?
About being a cat.
That's it.
Like memories. That was a great
the
song.
The cool alley cat guy that does a lot of fucking.
Yeah.
Or you could be the smart cat.
Yeah, it could be Mr. You, Mistopheles.
Right.
You said Rum Tum Tigger.
Rum Tum Tigger.
You know.
Oh, geez, where'd it go? Ding, ding. Okay, we get it, Anthony. So, and then at the end, I guess one of the cats dies, and she gets taken up to the big cat heaven or
and
something.
And then it goes, doo,
in the giant fucking flying tire thing.
Yep.
Wow, you saw this thing.
I saw Cats a couple of times.
It's a good play.
Never saw Cats.
It was a good date play because it was, you know, when, back in the day. Because everybody knew of it, and you almost seemed like you had some culture.
Was it sold out a lot?
No, you know what? Toward the end, it was just a bunch of Japanese businessmen that were given free tickets.
Yeah.
So they would be literally asleep in the seats, and the cats would be like creeping around in the audience.
I think I saw it right before it closed. It wasn't really hard to get tickets.
Wasn't sold out?
No, not at the end.
Can we see? Let me see a clip of it. Like, a moment.
Was it just sad at that point, Sam?
Well,
sad.
I mean, I still enjoyed it. And that
must have been a bitch. All the fucking makeup they had to put on and shit.
Yeah, like, come on.
And they're wearing
even cares
cat
anymore.
Suits. No one gives a shit. They're in these heavy cat suits and wearing cat makeup.
Didn't they get cancer or something?
Did they?
Was there some kind of lawsuit over
feline?
The...
Hang
on, it looks like a house with people on an iPad. That's for updating.
No, that's
is that where the cats go meow meow when they buy an app or something?
No.
Yes, cat makeup.
Yes, cat makeup.
Why are people arguing with me? It's cat makeup. I swear.
Good enough.
There we go.
We understood what you meant by it.
Oh, is this memory.
It's my favorite song.
Yeah. Oh, I remember. Yeah.
Why do they put this song in this thing?
This is a great song.
Is it a?
This is an this is from Cats. They put it in. Cats. They wrote it.
I thought it was from another thing, and they just put it in this.
Andrew Lloyd Webber wrote it for Cats.
Yes,
it's a beautiful song.
You can never tell what the fucking actors looked like, though.
They were cats.
They
had that
they're dressed like cats.
That must have been hot under all that stuff.
Imagine smelling the asshole part of someone's cat suit.
God. Oh, God. Mr. Mistopheles cat suit ass.
You know they want to save money. They weren't cleaning those things often.
All right.
Just going out there.
Well, she kicks it up into the, you know.
She used to be such a pretty kitten.
Right.
Now
she's
an old cat. Nobody loves her anymore.
She's remembering that she was a cute kitten. And
that probably reminds people of when they were younger.
Yes, see? That's exactly a line in the song, I think. She remembers.
I remember going duty in the box and kicking it all over the floor. Something of that nature.
And out of everybody that gave their little story, I guess the little cat court decided she should be the one that goes up to the great fucking whatever it is.
Cat heaven?
Cat heaven. Mm. Yeah.
Oh, this song.
Right.
It does not. It's a great song.
Oh, my God.
It's just one of those dumb songs that reminds you you're getting old and you're going to die.
It's
Carpenters did that shit.
That's as up and peppy as Send in the Clowns.
Jim Croce did that shit.
Yeah.
Kansas did that shit.
By the way, I saw
those songs that are like, oh, yeah, that's right.
Dust in the wind.
Oh, that's good.
Eventually, no one's gonna dust in the wind?
Basically, that song says, eventually, no one's going to remember you were on planet Earth.
Especially especially when that song first came out. It's like, I was smoking a lot of pot back then.
Yeah.
And it would just freak you out.
Of course it did.
Oh, we are just dust in the wind, man.
This fucking music is brutal.
Picking, finger picking his guitar. Yeah, man.
I don't mind a good love song, but this shit that reminds you you're gonna get old and die and no one's gonna remember you.
It's terrible.
Who needs it?
I close my eyes only for a moment, then the moment's gone.
You gotta do the harmony part.
My dreams.
Hate this song. I've always hated this song.
I like this. It's a good song.
Yeah.
It's not a good song because it's like too sad.
I like sad songs.
Yeah, boy.
All we are is dust in the wind.
Great.
Thanks. Thank you.
Doesn't matter at the end of the day, does it?
No.
You want to listen to Mr. Mistopheles? That's an upbeat song.
Which one is that?
I fell into a
magical Mr. Mistopheles.
I fell into a Harry Chapin fucking spiral yesterday.
Oof.
It's all I was doing is watching Harry Chapin videos.
I wish
miserable.
You did on the expressway.
But he's another one, depressing guy, man.
Yes.
Yes.
Terrible. Why would you listen to that?
He's a genius, but he was a depressing guy.
Freak yourself out. Yeah, he was a depressed guy, huh? Yeah. Just fucking singing about his kid that ain't fucking there anymore.
Cat with a spoon or something?
Yeah, something like
that. Anything better than going to a wake and they have to break out like the dust in the wind or something? It's like, really? I guess we weren't sad enough for you. Thanks.
Yeah. A neighbor of mine died in like a motorcycle accident. His family was like all a bunch of, you know, biker kind of guys. And they didn't want a, you know, regular kind of funeral.
Yeah.
And they were playing like, I got a peaceful, easy feeling. And I'm like, no, I don't. I got a horrible feeling. It's not peaceful or easy. It's terrible.
Yeah, we don't need to be sadder. We're all sad.
We're all
Trust me. Trust me, we're sad here.
Trying to fucking fake me out with some music.
Well, we did the same shit, so I'm guilty too. But we did the Green Day Time of Your Life, whatever the fuck the song is, and my dad's thing. Not my choice. I lost on that one. Yeah. We don't need to do that, people. We're all sad.
Yeah.
I suggest you go with some kind of upbeat little number.
Yeah. Like?
Happy birthday?
Yeah. Something, I don't know.
Yeah.
E-Rock.
There we go.
Oh, who told him to play this?
Bravo. See the fucking body in the coffin?
With a plunger in his hands?
What?
All right, it's over. Oops.
Bow bomb. Bomb, 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 bomb.
Oh, this is giving in everybody's head today. That's
great. Yay! What a happy song that is. That's no Cats in the Cradle.
And I know Dustin Wynn was an old school, relax people, but I think they were kind of making fun of that whole fucking thing.
Yeah.
You play a depressing song in a wake.
Believe me, we all fucking.
Or whatever. Yeah. Johnny, what do you got, buddy?
Do that.
Hi to the boys.
Hey.
Happy birthday, Jimmy. Fucking. Saddest song I ever reminds you that your dad's gonna die any minute now is Mike and the Mechanics in the Living Years.
Oh God! Yeah.
God, remember that one?
How does that go?
The Living Years.
They were on the other day. I was like, oh yeah, Mike and the Mechanics.
Good old Mike and the Mechanics, Mikey from Genesis. There doing his solo thing.
Oh, is that who that was?
Mm-hmm. He wound up having a couple of hits.
That thing, right? What's the other song?
He did have another one, though.
He did?
Yes, definitely.
What's this about?
This thing will fucking...
All I need is a miracle. Was that them? All I need is you. Wasn't that Mike and the Mechanics?
Wasn't that Michael McDonald? No. I mean, not Michael McDonald. Yeah.
Yes, they're saying yes,
it
and.
Is. Yeah.
It is. Wow. Thank you. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, this thing will
fucking... Oh. All of their
frustration. All right, I don't have to do this.
Oh, this is terrible.
Like clapping out of tune?
You're doing it. Out of tune. Off key. Out of tune. Wait a minute. Off rhythm. Oh, this is... And now the Cars kicks in, right? Throw the spaghetti against the wall. Drive home all drunk and scare your son that you're going to go off the edge of the Ortega Highway. Look.
Don't grow up to be a faggot.
Don't be a faggot. Next time you scream like that, you better have an arrow in your chest. Look, I'm a good dad. I'm beating up that gay Mexican guy that tried to pick you up.
But they had problems when the old man was alive, and then he realized maybe they didn't really have problems and he should have said some shit.
Yeah, like it all just amounts to nothing when they're gone. You realize you should have maybe
should have said
been
some
nicer.
Things.
Said nicer things.
That's so you can live your life better, by the way.
Right.
Because the dead guy doesn't know the difference.
He don't have a fucking clue.
Right. You do that for you.
Right.
This song doesn't get me.
No.
I don't hate it. But it's just like background dreck.
There's other sadder songs that you could fucking pop on.
This was massively successful.
Of course it was. I wouldn't question its success. I just don't like it. I don't hate it either. It's like
trying that gospel-y sound.
Yeah.
What was this, late 80s?
Yeah.
Sounds like it. Maybe early 90s.
You give me a good WOLD any day.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
A lot of gospel back then.
Yeah.
They were doing a gospel thing with their rock and roll.
Yeah, it was very good for your image to just have about 50 black people behind you rocking back and forth in church attire, singing the chorus with you.
Where did all those people go?
Everyone did that.
Yeah. Yeah, you two did it. I don't know. Whatever.
Phil Collins
did it.
I'm pretty sure he did it. Yeah.
I hate that part. Like that little picky guitar.
Yeah. All the things I had to say. All right.
Can we go to break?
Yeah, enough of this guy.
I'm going to pee my pants.
Go make wee-wees.
Let's go make wee-wees. Kevin Smith calling in today.
Ooh. What's he got going on?
Feel bad for his Devils, but whatever. It's inevitable that LA Kings will win the Stanley Cup.
Oh,
everyone relax.
Isn't that what you said? And then they took two games, I guess?
All right, but let's relax. It's LA Kings 3 games, Devils 2.
The Kings fans are hating you on Twitter.
Well.
Oh, man.
Why? I just tell like it is.
Because you said there's no way the Devils are getting it.
I congratulated Colin Hanks.
Have taken, they got this one wrapped up, you said.
It wasn't 3-1?
And then Devils.
It was 3-0. Now it's 3-2.
Now it's 3-2.
But let's all relax. The Kings got this thing.
Oh, jeez.
They really got this thing.
Oh, my God.
They're by far the better team. They've proven it the entire year and through the playoffs.
Oh, boy. All right.
I'll tell you what happened. Colin Hanks was in, and Colin Hanks was really bummed he couldn't go to the game in L.A. because he was here promoting. So the Kings are just waiting for Colin Hanks to get back home.
Oh, is that what it was?
Yeah.
I remember you saying that they got it all wrapped up. Don't worry about it. And I remember saying... Take all your money and put it on the Devils.
It's not happening.
And they did win.
It's not happening. Let's all relax.
Again, take all your money and put it on the Devils.
No, it's not
tonight.
Happening. I'm telling you, relax.
What is it, 6 o'clock tonight?
No, I think... Are they going for a 6 o'clock game?
I think, right?
Oh, that'd be nice. Could actually stay up and watch it.
7:30?
And who do you got in the NBA Finals?
Might as well do what's this NBA? Right now. What is that?
You got Oklahoma City and the Miami Heat. Who you got?
I got to go with the super team.
You think LeBron finally wins a ring, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
No way.
Yeah, he's good.
Oklahoma all the way.
Oh, boy.
Durant.
Oh, no. That can only mean
It's not happening. It's not happening.
It's not happening.
It's not happening.
It ain't happening, man.
Okay.
You know the Devils aren't going to win it, right?
No.
Get out of here.
I wouldn't have given it a second thought. I'd have been like, all right, well, the Kings got this wrapped up. And then when you said it, it's like, oh, my God, no. He just threw that monkey wrench in there. And then to see them take 2 games after that.
That makes it interesting. That's all.
Certainly does.
But the Kings got this thing easy. Easily.
Oh, no.
Keep
up your good nature.
Can we pee now?
Yeah.
And we never did the...
Yeah, fix that shirt, man. That muscles are bursting. In the middle right there, those ab muscles.
This is a gut.
No, it's not. They're ab muscles.
You know what you do to me on a regular basis?
What, that V? That's fucking pushing out.
Jeez, he let himself go. No, not really. I've looked like this for a good 10 years
you
now.
You see it, don't you?
I do.
Home run calls when we get back.
Oh, yeah.
What happened? Ooh. Something happened?
I'm just looking at the GOG getting hit, trying to see if it's...
She's doing with a gun on stage. Now she's taking advantage of the whole
thing. Why does she have a gun, a rifle on stage, too? What's that part about the song?
That she's holding?
Yeah.
That's a gun / keyboard.
You know, I don't appreciate that she's glorifying guns like that.
I'll talk to her about it.
Why would she have a keyboard / gun on stage? I don't get it.
On her last show, she had a keyboard in the hood of a car. It was amazing.
That was great.
Yeah.
Was it?
Yeah. And that little bus was on stage?
Yep.
Mm. Oh, God. Right.
Yay for the bus.
Props.
I like a good
She was on her way to the Monsters Mall.
Yeah. Well, Monsters were going to go there. Hi.
Mother Monster was leading the pack.
Mother Monster?
Mm-hmm. Mother Monster? No way.
That's Mother Monster, Lady Gaga.
Do your teeth hurt?
This is terrible.
Yeah, I the whole Monster thing, I do like the music in the show a lot, but hello, Mother Monster. I'm Mother Monster. No,
yeah, but they all have that now. I don't like that at all. Justin Bieber's got the Beliebers.
Chris has the what's his have?
The Breezy.
Oh, Team Breezy.
That's Team Breezy.
Team Breezy.
You gotta be a Breezy.
They're all
what about Taylor Swift? Doesn't she have one?
Yeah, I can't remember what hers is.
And what about Katy Perry? Doesn't she have one?
I'm not sure about Katy Perry.
Wait, what is what is Taylor Swift? Because I like her, too. Because you're mean. I like that song.
Oh, really? You like that?
I do.
She's
awesome.
Yeah, she is talented.
For a pretty girl, too.
I mean, she writes all her own shit, right? Yeah. Lady Gaga doesn't.
Lady Gaga writes most of her own songs.
No, she doesn't.
Sure she does. She's a very talented
songwriter. She really doesn't. I know the guy that writes all her stuff.
You do not.
He just wants to be behind the scenes.
She's a good songstress.
He doesn't want anyone to know.
It's a good word to describe
Thank you.
Her.
I try to get that one in once a show. It's hard to say songstress.
The Beatles turned 50. Holy fuck.
Yeah. 50 and people still fucking listen to this shit. It's amazing.
Like it was yesterday.
Fucking amazing.
Get it. Get it. Get it.
Yes.
Get
it. Like get it was it. Yesterday.
Get it.
Exactly.
Get it. Get it.
Yeah.
It's a Beatles song. Yesterday.
Yes, it is.
Get it.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to pee my pants.
Oh, yeah.
I'd love to see that.
We'll Let's do it.
A little spot.
All right.
A little spot.
Oh, no. Actually, I can't pee now because it hurts so bad.
Oh, no.
You just got to relax. Sometimes if I brush my nipple lightly, it helps me tingle.
Can you imagine controlling the weather with your hand?
Oh, it'd be great.
Or there's a band everywhere you walk in?
Yes.
Ah, da, 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 like that scene in The Godfather.
Control the weather with your fist. Make a mudslide.
Sirius XM. The Opie and Anthony Show. All I need is a miracle.
All I need is you. So this was Mike and the Mechanics, huh?
Mike and the Mechanics.
Yes, it was.
Man,
their,
I should have known that.
Their other hit. Kinda. Sorta. Had the Genesis sound to it, the background, that staccato kind of thing.
Without the other guys.
Yeah.
It was his part in Genesis.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
That's what I do for Genesis.
Genesis.
So, John Sterling.
Oh.
Once again, I was at Yankee Stadium on Saturday night, and, man, they really do embrace John Sterling because the Yankees, you know, wrap it up and they beat the Mets.
Yeah.
And on the massive scoreboard or whatever, the big Jumbotron.
Yeah.
I don't think they call them Jumbotrons anymore,
it's like
do
the
they?
Big fucking board.
Trinitron, whatever. They have a close-up of John Sterling fucking in that epileptic
fit.
Oh,
and he does the Yankees win.
So obviously...
Yankees win?
Obviously that's recorded, and I guess they play it after every Yankee victory at home.
Oh, man, it's
so
recorded.
So they really thing. Like John Jeez. Sterling.
So they've gotten it to the point where it's pre-recorded.
It
and
had to be.
Wow.
It had to be. It's pre-recorded, right?
What?
On the big screen?
On
when
the
you...
big screen?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, because it's...
And John Sterling
final
does the Yankees
out.
Win.
It was...
The Yankees
yeah,
win.
Final it, out, it he must, was on the big screen.
I didn't know
just losing
that.
With his weak fucking wrists. Look at his wrists next time.
See, that's why he does it. They indulge him.
They really do. You're
yeah.
right.
I don't know why.
They're douchebags.
A classy organization like the Yankees. Not, you know, I'm a Mets fan.
It's very gimmicky for a team like the Yankees.
You think, right?
Yeah.
You'd expect the Brewers to do that shit.
Yeah.
Yankees don't do anything like the friggin' terrible towels and thunder sticks.
Cowbells
and like
Tampa
that.
Bay.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the yeah. Sterling thing's pretty rough, eh?
It's terrible.
I
it's
know.
It's pretty rough.
I got to agree
well,
with you.
You just
today,
wait
Mikey.
Till you hear what I pulled.
Oh, boy. Oh.
Name one thing in baseball that's rougher than the John Sterling home run call.
Oh, tomahawk.
The thunder sticks, whatever they're called. And the, it's not that bad.
You didn't like that back in the 90s?
No. Oh. Oh, this is him.
You know how fucking sick of people that you must be when you're in the booth?
It's like this.
Yeah.
Yep. Oh, Yankees! Well, you're not that excited. It's not about you.
No.
Well,
it is with them.
They have decided it is because when they win, that's what you see on the big screen.
Yeah.
Him losing his fucking mind saying the Yankees win. But here he is with some home run calls. We love the home run calls.
Here's Cano with A-Rod on the first.
He's from Friday night.
And the pitch is swung on, drilled to right. It is high. It is far. It is gone.
Move.
He's done it again.
Perfect.
Robbie
stop
Cano
right there, please.
With
please
two,
stop right there.
Two-run home runs.
Okay, you can stop.
In his first two
stop.
Times at bat.
Uh-oh. Done.
Robbie Cano, don't you know, his two-run blast gives the Yankees a 4-0 lead.
Don't you know?
How do the fucking Yankees think that's good?
And why do you have to do it every time?
Robbie Cano.
How about break it out every once in a while, maybe?
Don't you know?
That's as good as it's going to get as far as these clips go.
Oh, really? Oh,
no.
Boy.
Oh, no.
He drilled it a fur piece in the second deck, the 2-0. Swung on and into the air to deep left. That ball is high. It is far. That is gone.
That's good.
Nick Swisher drills one deep in the seats and left down the line.
That's great.
Nick Swisher rounding third. Positively swish-alicious. and Cano and Swisher go back to back, belly to belly, and the Yankees take a 5-0 lead.
He does a little chuckle.
Fucking terrible.
I'm gonna have to hear the end of that again because I like his little laugh. Back to back, belly to belly.
Swishalicious, and Cano and Swisher go back to back. Belly to belly, and the Yankees take a 5-0 lead.
I tell you one thing though, because even Esty at the Cellar, who fucking never does anything but love the Yankees, and she would always defend him. And I talked to her the other night, and she's like, "I can't even listen to him anymore. She cannot listen to him. You've lost Esty."
Wow.
Everyone is turning on John Sterling and thinking he stinks now.
Back to back.
I can't find anybody who enjoys it. Like, not one person I've talked to likes it.
That's what's so confusing about that thing.
They're out of touch. That's what that means.
And a belly to belly. That's it, I guess?
No, no. There's a third track on there.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah.
All right.
Nice.
Now, Santana to the wind and the 2-2. Swung on and drilled to deep left. It is high. It is far. It is gone. What a shot.
Block size.
Andrew Jones hit a long home run to deep left. He's Mary Andrew keeping up with the Joneses, and the Yankees go back to back to back.
Wait, what was the first part?
He's Mary Andrew? Is what I... This is it's new. He didn't do Mary Andrew last year.
Keeping up with the Joneses.
But what's the Mary Andrew part?
Last year, it was Andrew Jones makes his bones.
Oh.
Makes duty?
Yeah.
Fucking... Andrew Jones made his bones while you were doing cheerleaders. Oh, green.
What?
Mary Andrew.
Is a film?
It's an American musical film from 1958.
And I guess Keeping Up with the Joneses is probably in that.
And no, it's an expression. It's two different things.
Yeah, but is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, Keeping Up with the Joneses is an expression.
Yeah,
some guys get two.
Yeah. Oh, the Grandy Man! Oh, the Grand! Here's what I want to hear one day. Ah, the Grandy! Go to break, go to break!
The Grandy Man!
Hit a long home run to deep left. He's Mary Andrew, keeping up with the Joneses, and the Yankees go back to back to back, and a belly to belly to belly, and the Yankees have a 6-0 lead.
A triple.
Shit.
Now that was another shot.
Oh, and then it just gets better.
I give you guys a little dessert.
That was another shot.
Yeah.
What did she say?
Nick
John!
Here's a really important observation from Suzyn.
What did fucking
Waldman.
Yogurt mouth say? All the moistest mouth in the fucking planet? Yeah, what did old yogurt gum say?
I really should listen every day because I would just bring you guys discs.
We need
Suzyn
more
Waldman.
Suzyn Waldman.
I love Suzyn Waldman.
The Yankee
Waldman.
Organization's out of their fucking minds because then they have Suzyn Waldman that has the heavy Boston accent.
Yeah.
And Yankee fans hate
the
Red Sox.
And after every home run call, she just bulldozes right in and just gives what you'll hear, just an inane observation.
Well, you know, John.
Nothing lead.
Now, that was another shot. Nick Swisher came running down the dugout. I thought he was going to run out the field to greet Andrew Jones. And, boy, what a shot that was.
Oh, my God.
Fuck her.
I thought he was going to run up the field.
She thinks crazy.
Yeah. Stop telling us what they're doing.
I thought.
Yeah. Oh, Pettit's having a Gatorade. No one gives a fuck.
I thought.
Run out of the stadium.
What?
Yeah, Nick Swisher ran out of the dugout.
I thought he was going to tongue kiss Cano.
It's just stuff that doesn't have to be said.
I know.
No.
It stinks.
Oh, that's hilarious and awful.
It stinks.
Oh, where is it?
Yeah, we got to hear her again.
Swisher came running down the dugout. I thought he was going to run out the field to greet Andrew Jones. And what a shot that was.
She realized she got a zero
she just
on that.
Nothing.
So she goes, and
do you think Sterling hates her?
That he's going to run up
the
field.
Responds.
Yeah, because he wants it all about himself.
No.
He didn't give her anything on that?
No. That's why she awkwardly laughed.
I like that when she laughs at herself, and then she stops because she realizes that's it, and then goes,
yeah.
And, like, the whole tone and, is changed. Yeah.
Run up the field!
Wait, oh, she's looking for a buddy to commiserate with?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, turning her head left and right, looking right. Am I right, guys?
Can we hear that one more time now with this in mind?
Fantastic.
Swisher came running down the dugout. I thought he was going to run out the field to greet Andrew Jones. And, boy, what a shot.
Just because you know Sterling's probably giving her a dirty look, like, shut up.
He's mumbling, bitch. Cunt.
Stand alone.
Man, I'm working on my next home run call. Will you shut the fuck up?
Yeah.
Run up the field, greet her. It's Jones.
I'll bet you she tries even sucking up to him, like, oh, yeah, you're right, John. The Grandy Man sure can. When he hits a home run, give me some more yogurt for my mouth. My mouth isn't quite moist enough.
The Grandy
Man. I want a goggle with yogurt. I take mouth moistening pills. I sound like Ted Sheckler from Boston.
A little bit.
She doesn't sound like she's from Boston at all, does she?
Oh,
let's
God,
go to Sammy and Queens.
Sammy.
Sammy picked up the phone. I thought he was going to go dial it or something.
What? That was Chip.
I know.
Chip Waldman.
We're trying to get more Suzyn Waldman on the show.
Yeah, what are you going to do, Johnny? You gonna, what's Roger Clemens? What kind of box is he get or something?
Chip Waldman. Terrible.
The home run, how come he doesn't hit an apartment run or something?
You're terrible.
He had a double, what's that, a triple double or something? Hey, you're John Sterling, does that mean you like silver or something?
They're both going to go bye-bye because ESPN is purchasing the radio broadcast rights. I knew that.
Oh, what? Good.
Are they?
Yeah, they're going to go bye-bye.
Oh,
fucking
wow.
ESPN's not going to put up with that shit.
Man, what is it, CBS FM?
Yeah, it's
They've
CBS.
Had it for a while.
Yep. Let's say hi to Sammy.
Yeah, good morning, boy.
Yeah,
Sammy.
Yeah. Who are you, Sammy Davis Jr. or something?
Goddamn shit. Before every game, in her horrible accent, she has to announce John Sterling as the voice of the Yankees. Like he's entering the studio. Meanwhile, he's been sitting next to her the whole pregame.
Mm. What am I supposed to do? Introduce him as like the ears of the Yankees or something?
No, there, Chip Waldman.
Oh, she sucks.
Let's say hi to Matt in Connecticut, Matt.
Hey, says Matt, what are you laying on the floor in front of the door and something?
That's a good one, Chip. the most embarrassing part about going to a Yankee game is in the seventh inning stretch, they play God Bless America, but it sounds like they're holding a microphone to an old Victrola. It's just the worst recording of a song. And then they play it out, and it's just awful. Like, couldn't they get something better than that?
Oh.
What?
I know what he's talking about. I've heard it.
Sure, but that doesn't make it a good call.
It's supposed to be like.
What, Vic Trolla? What is he? What is Vic just writing on the message board?
He's a troll. Vic Trolla.
Posada new. But then Posada old too.
Oh, no. Oh, it's KNEW. Posada new. Posada new.
Test! And then it's grinning from ear to ear, but it's going around the back of something. This will be one of those one break characters.
Yeah, you know. Those two.
Until I bring more Suzyn Waldman.
Every so often.
You gotta bring more Suzyn Waldman.
Yeah. What about Suzyn Floydman?
Let me go see if I can get something.
Oh, really?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
How about on YouTube?
Yeah, they got it. There's gotta be some good stuff.
Yeah.
There.
Z.
Suzyn Waldman.
Oh, God, is she awful?
She's terrible. Look at her.
She's horrendous.
Oh my God.
All her pictures are great.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. She looks exactly like she sounds.
Yes.
Like.
Yep.
Exactly.
I look like I had a face transplant after a chimp attack or something.
Oh my God.
She does look like this.
I look like they're putting Botox in my face with a fire hose or something.
Wow.
Wow.
Chip Waldman.
I love being Chip Waldman.
Chip Waldman's great.
Why does she even
new material?
Why does she even bother doing her hair?
Oh, yeah, it's awful.
Why do anything?
Fuck, save some time.
A necklace, lipstick, earrings. Why?
Yeah, I'm wrong. Yankees are going to keep Suzyn and John Sterling after the contract. All right.
Oh.
All right. Fair enough. Jerry and Jersey. Did we play this one already?
Sometimes you get complacent. Sometimes you forget how hard it is. We didn't forget. And then he said something that everybody in the room, we all looked at each other. Oh, yeah. He said, this Yankee team has a great future. It's got a lot of young kids. There is no question about the ability of these people. They're very impressive. He said, you think it's going to last forever. And
talking about Sandusky.
Your friend. He said... This has been the best 12 years of my life. I wouldn't have missed this for anybody. Now, I was okay, actually, until I went into the clubhouse, and the coaches are sitting in Tori's office.
And I saw those big black cocks or something. In the clubhouse. I left Boston, Massachusetts with one bad accent and a dream to fuck up a baseball game.
And two bad...
First thing was, this dream come true.
She is fucking horrible. Just horrible. Susan Waldman. Started off John Sterling and went right to Waldman.
I never get tired of teasing her.
No. It's great.
She loves it, though. She's got the passion for the job.
Yeah.
The job.
Oh, that's her?
You walk too fast. Slow down a bit.
What?
Advertisement.
Oh.
Can you see that?
Oh, it looked like Suzyn Waldman from behind. That's what made that very confusing.
Wait a minute, that doesn't look like her.
Suzyn Waldman in the new pictures has hair like Harry and the Hendersons. I modeled my hair after the Sasquatch.
Yankee Stadium spotlight.
Yeah.
All right.
Hi, everyone. Joe Auriemma here at the new Yankee Stadium. This is the home opener, and I'm here with the one, the only, Suzyn Waldman. Hey, Suzyn, how are you doing?
I hope I'm the only one. They don't want another one. I
hope there's not two of me or something. I hope I'm the only one.
What is she saying? I hope I'm the only one.
I don't know.
It doesn't make any sense.
I hope no one else has my Bee Gees at age 50 wig on.
Oh, my God. Hold on. I got to take this call from one of our regulars, Mongo the Trucker. Mongo.
Hey, she looks like Dustin Hoffman in Tootsie.
She does.
Perfect phone call, by the way. Perfect phone call. He hung up after that.
In and out.
Let's see this.
You're the best. Now, let me ask you about this new ballpark. What's your, we're here for the first two exhibition games. What's your first impression?
Well,
my first impression is it's going to be Christopher Walken or something. Hey, sis. I do lots of impressions. Here's John Sterling or something. What are you, Grandy Manning or something? It's impressions that she does.
Of course. What are your impressions? And then she does impressions.
Exhibition games, what's your first impression?
Well, I have kind of mixed feelings. I loved the other place. My whole career took place in that other place. And before
place.
That
place,
career,
place, I... place. So I like to say place a lot.
Something about the place,
John. Because when people look at me, they bet on me to show a place. Posada's in the place. Something about a uniform. You have a uniform. Her hair is hideous.
Oh, it's terrible.
What does she look like? That hairdo is fucking...
Oh, she needs some conditioner.
Yeah. Who does she look like? Oof.
Fucking monster.
No, but her face... you know who she looks like? In only the face. She looks like Darth Vader after he took his helmet off. Skywalker's my son or something. Oh, she's a fucking disaster.
What a mess.
So much my time was spent in there. Right. This is beautiful. And when you sit in the booth or sit in the stands, you
name
think
more
you're
places.
In Yankee Stadium. Yeah. So it looks both just like stands, Yankee Stadium,
the
except
bleachers.
The seats are more comfortable and there's more leg room.
Right.
And I hear there's more restrooms and you don't have
rooms.
To stand in line for an hour and a half to get food. It's absolutely beautiful. I think when we all get a little used to where we're going,
right.
It'll be a little better and it'll feel more like home. But it sure is a gorgeous place.
And you mentioned the old Yankee Stadium.
It's a bore.
Well, let me tell ya.
Travis will get some good
sounds like she's like her nose is constantly stuffed with loose, moist snot.
Blah!
All right, there's
there she is.
When
we
pride of our team.
When we break now because we got Kevin Smith calling in.
Oh, all right.
I don't. What is he promoting?
The movie that he's SModcast Pictures is distributing movies now.
SModcast Pictures?
And so he's picked up this movie.
He's turning into a mogul, Kevin Smith.
And he didn't direct this one. He just he bought the rights to it. And they're distributing it the same way they did Red State on the, you know, on the bus.
Nice.
On the road trip.
Big, and he's a big Devils fan. It's too bad.
Yeah.
Too bad that Devils are not going to World Cup this year.
What's he laughing at?
Everybody quoting Chip
Waldman.
Kevin Smith next. Stay there.
Sirius XM. This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
I didn't want to do this. Jimmy wants to do this. Because I get blamed for a lot of shit.
What?
Bobo's on the line. I was trying to avoid him.
I wanted to hear this, too, though, because apparently he's got a new character.
All right. Bobo.
Yeah.
You're really ready for the call, huh?
I got to be honest with you, Bobo. I forgot that you were a Mets fan. I had an extra ticket for this big game at Yankee Stadium the other night.
All right. That's okay. I understood if you forgot.
Yeah, I did.
Very forgettable.
Huh?
You would have taken him if you had remembered?
No. What do you got, Bobo? Sucks.
Well, I got a crazy story that happened. There's a neighbor that's been driving my mother freaking nuts.
No.
Yeah.
Bubba, hold on. I just want to get something straight right away. Don't use any names, okay?
All right. I'm not using any names.
Even though his name is Pete. Yeah, no names.
What's his name?
Oh, no.
I can't use the name, but I am going to describe the person, all right?
All right, who is it?
These are these people from Russian family.
Why are they in a hurry or something?
Why do they eat dinner on magnetic trays with real linen napkins?
Dumb magnetic trays.
Those magnetic trays.
Those fucking napkins must smell.
I want to go in there with a bulk eraser. Just take care of his magnetic trays so they all fall on the floor.
I should bring my fucking James Pierce shirt in there and get the thing taken off it with his trays.
All right, go ahead.
Well, they keep bothering my mother. They keep bothering my
buttering?
Mother.
Buttering.
Buttering.
They keep buttering.
How are they bothering her?
Buttering.
Are they booing her womb and vagina?
Well, for one thing, they got two cats that roam the hallway. There's like a hallway between the upstairs and downstairs. Like they live upstairs. But these cats keep pissing. And they keep masking the smell with some cologne. Like that's supposed to help make anything better.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
It makes it even worse. A mixture of stellar cat piss and cologne.
Sounds great.
This is a crazy story, though.
Fucking nuts.
It is crazy.
Holy shit.
Kevin Smith, what's up, buddy?
I don't want to interrupt on that crazy story.
Hey, Kevin.
God.
Don't you worry, sir. You're way more important.
Not at all. Hardly important. I'm a larger, that's for sure. How's everybody doing out there?
I feel bad for you. I feel bad for you with this Devils thing, man. It's just a matter of time before the Kings take it, huh?
Now I know what it feels like to be an Islanders fan. Constant state of loss. No, it's been fantastic. I mean, this is what you want out of a Stanley Cup, like drama. Mm. For the first three games, everyone's like, it's in the bag. The Kings got the cup. And then suddenly a turnaround. That's what makes the finals fun. That's what makes the Stanley Cup fun. Nobody wants to see us weep. Well, maybe Los Angeles did, but they don't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I'll tell you, Opie did say the other day that the Kings have this one in the bag. It's all done. And then the Devils took two. So.
Yeah, I know. That's what we need. We need more of that Opie thing.
Yeah.
Well, I got a weird sports curse, some people would say. But I was telling that before the show. I like going for a good underdog, usually.
Right.
And that's why a lot of these things.
Why won't you go for the Devils?
Islanders, man, I can't do it. I can't do it. I got to be an Islanders fan.
It's been fantastic, though. It was tough the other night. Saturday night, I was watching the game, and then I could only watch two periods, and then we had a show. Me and Muse had a show at night.
Oh, nice.
So for the first hour of the show, I kept apologizing. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm not here. My head is back in that game. And then finally, somebody was like, Devils won from the background.
Oh, wow. You couldn't even watch the rest of it.
No, because we were on stage, and I thought about like bringing up my laptop, just quietly putting the game on.
Yeah.
These people paid good money.
Yeah, but you know what? You would have made something out of it. You're good that way. You would have put it into your show somehow.
The only problem with that is I was at a comic book convention.
Oh, okay.
So,
right, yeah.
In the world, I can rock any sports references is at a comic book.
You got to kind of know your audience, right?
Two completely like different worlds.
It would be like me going to a gathering of devils, and I'm like, what's with Anakin Skywalker?
Hey, somebody tweeted me the other day, Kevin. Hi, buddy.
Somebody brought you up the other day. No lie, I swear to God. I was at the comic book convention. It was in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Really great show. Stan Lee introduced us.
Oh, wow.
Cool. Ooh, so I'm on stage, and people, you know, we get to the part of the show, we do a little Q&A. So people are yelling out questions and stuff. Somebody goes, is blah, blah, blah going to be and hit somebody? And I was like, yeah, man, that's the aim. It was Muse. They're like, is Jay going to be and hit somebody? I said, yeah. From the back of the auditorium, is Jimmy Norton going to be and hit somebody? And I said, yes, he's my pukey goalie.
And somebody tweeted me that. I didn't know if they were saying that or if it came from you. That's the first time. Thank you.
Yeah, that's you've got the nervous stomach, just like we talked about.
Yes.
Glenn Hall.
Do I have to take skating lessons?
No, because you're a goalie. So all you have to do is be able to stay in balance on your skates.
Okay. I was thinking of taking skating lessons.
Or maybe you give them fake skates.
Totally, man.
Where they look like skates, but they're little shoes.
That's what we did to Rogan on Zach and Miri. At one point in Zach and Miri, we've got a hockey scene. And Seth's from Canada, so I remember when we were talking about the movie before we even got out there. I was like, and then there's the hockey scene, man, which you could probably do in your sleep. And he's like, I'm the only Canadian who doesn't play hockey.
So great.
Oh, wow.
So we put literally shoes on them and stuff like that. If you look in the hockey scene in Zag and Miri, there's limited mobility by Seth. That's because he couldn't stand on the skates.
This is going to be a little obscure, but going with your point, I watched that Jim Carrey Penguin movie over the weekend. It's a kid movie.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Popper's Penguins.
Oh, is it horrendous. And they have a really bad skating scene in that movie. Look out for it.
A couple of years back, I remember going in to meet on that movie. It was after Zach and Miri, and a bunch of people were like, hey, man, why don't you direct somebody else's script? I wound up doing Cop Out. One of the movies I met on was Mr. Popper's Penguins, and it was Ben Stiller at that point.
They had a kid
play Popper.
When the penguins show up, they had the kid bending down to try to, you know, pet the penguin because it's going to be his pet for his birthday party.
Yeah. Right.
The CGI is so horrendous. The kid didn't know where he was supposed to be petting the invisible penguin.
Really?
And they left it in the movie. I'm like, didn't someone see this and go, all right, we got to redo this somehow?
They're just sitting there going, who cares?
Yeah, yeah,
I
really.
I think they did.
Fuck it. What are we going to do it again?
I think they did, but whatever. Hey, you got SModcast Pictures now. That's cool.
I do. I mean, let me. We were going to be coming into town this week to do the Bindlestis, which is a flick we picked up at the film festival Slam Dance. It won the Audience Award. Dude, I'm not even lying. Like, when I say this movie is fucking hysterical, it is absolutely hysterical. I watched it for the first 10 minutes going like, all right, I'm going to see The Influence. Soon I'm going to see a Judd Apatow in this, or I'm going to see maybe a little bit of myself, or I'm going to see some Wes Anderson. There's got to be an influence here. You watch that whole movie, man, by about 15 minutes in, you're like, there is no influence. This is the real deal. They're finally, somebody's saying something original in a comedy. And it's a high school comedy, so, you know, right away you're like, everyone must look like they're 25. They were actually kids when they shot it in high school. It's frightening, dude.
Wow.
Really, really good. Anyway, we were going to be taking that out this week, but unfortunately we had a spoilers emergency. There's the show that we're doing on Hulu right now called Spoilers.
Okay.
And there's a very cool guest that we couldn't get any other week but this week, so we have to postpone the tour.
Yeah.
So we're doing it in August. But it is a cool thing. SModcast Pictures presents. And when I come back in August with it, I'll let you all know when where you can see it and whatnot. That was supposed to be this week, but then last night we had to pull the plug and move it to August.
So, all right, I'm confused. So people can't see Bindlestiffs yet?
Yeah, they can. It's going to be a delayed just a little bit longer, unfortunately.
But I mean, they can't see it as we talk to you. We got to wait till August.
Yes.
Okay, gotcha, gotcha.
It's a good problem and a bad problem. We've had a lot of stuff kind of happen with our little company over the course of the last 6 months, and or even longer. The last year has been wonderful for Smodco. From all that podcasting, man, came that Comic Book Men show on AMC. Mm-hmm. Then there came this show that we're doing on Hulu called Spoilers, which is so much fun, man. It's like a movie review show, but we don't review movies. We just talk about them, love on them. We say we don't review movies, we revere them, one of those taglines.
Right, right.
Then there's another TV show, which we just found out about Friday. Another one of our podcasts is turning into a broadcast, so we're all very stoked around here. It looks like this is the year where we just do a bunch of television, and it's a good thing, but at the same time, it winds up, you know, intruding on other aspects of your life.
You really make us feel good about ourselves as we sit here day in and day out with nothing.
Oh, my God, you guys got the killer job. I would trade my job with you guys. You know that in a heartbeat. Take mine.
We just kind of want to...
I'd rather sit around with a microphone in my face.
We would love to just branch out a little bit. That's all I'm saying.
Do you have an agent, Kevin, or do your own stuff?
I have an agent, but I'll be honest with you, and he's a good guy, but this year was the year that I tried to do a lot of my own stuff, because for years, ever since I got in the business, of course, you know, the moment you get an agent, and then some people get a manager. I never did that. But with an agent, you know, they're a Rolodex, and they open doors, and blah, blah, blah. So for years, everything I did through my agent. That's the way it's done. This year, you know, I started going like, well, how much can you do yourself? If you're letting other people do it, you're not really committed 100%. Like, let me see how far you could go without an agent, without a Rolodex and stuff. So this year, there were a few times where I kind of went out there by myself and didn't really kind of say, hey, man, can you set this up or can you do this? My agent was great last year. He put me into the book. I wrote that book, Tough Shit, and he set that up. I was in a pilot for a show called Tonightly, with Ralph Garman, who I do Hollywood Babylon with, and he set that up, and I was with Telepictures, so that was a nice paycheck. But everything else the last year, I kept trying to see if I could do stuff myself, and weird stuff. Sometimes it was like, let me see if I could set up this Hulu show without anybody else's help, without, you know, Endeavor. And so that happened. But there was this one thing I did. It was so stupid, but it was one of these things where I was like, let me see how far I could get without my agent. You know, I'm putting together this hockey thing, hit somebody, as we talked about before, Jimmy. One of the biggest hockey enthusiast in the business is also one of the most successful people, producers in not just the film business but TV business, Jerry Bruckheimer. Jerry Bruckheimer's a huge hockey fan. So I was like, maybe I get to Jerry Bruckheimer. Let me see how long it takes me to get to Jerry Bruckheimer without my agent. So I look online, and I find the main number for Bruckheimer Pictures or whatever it's called, and I call it up. And the chick answers the phone. She's like, Bruckheimer Productions, whatever. And I started chuckling because I was like, this is going to sound so weird to say, but is Jerry there? And the lady goes, may I ask who's calling? I said, this is Kevin Smith. And she goes, okay, what's it in regards to? And I said, I worked with Jerry a long time ago on Coyote Ugly because I did a rewrite on Coyote Ugly. Mm. And so I met him, nice guy, real cool guy, sits at a very long desk, very intimidating desk. So I said, I worked with him on Coyote Ugly. She goes, okay, hold on. She puts me on hold, and I'm sitting there going, I wonder what's going to happen. She's going to come back and be like, he doesn't know who you are. She comes back. She goes, Kevin. I said, yes. She goes, Kevin Smith? I said, yes. And what movie did you work on? Oh. I said, Coyote Ugly. And she goes, and what, were you craft service? And I go, no, I did a draft of the screenplay. And she goes, oh, you're a writer. And I said, yeah. She goes, okay, hold on. She puts me on hold, and there's pleasant music playing.
Oh.
5 minutes go by. At this point, I'm like, they must be on the other side having this discussion of, like, do you know? And he's like, I don't, it can't be him. Why wouldn't he call through his agent? Blah, blah, blah. I'm waiting. I think I'm about to get on the phone. She gets back on the phone with me. She goes, Mr. Smith, would it be possible to submit your question in writing to us?
Oh, shit.
And I said, yeah, man, absolutely. Is there an email address or something? And she goes, yeah, totally. It's reception.
Oh.
Bruckheimerpictures.com, whatever it was. So they were just giving me the mailbox and everything.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, totally. She gave me the address. And so I wrote the email. And
you actually did it. Not to interrupt you, but this is why you're going to live to be 100. Because you just said, okay. Like, instead of getting stressed out and self-righteous, which I would have, you just said, all right, no problem. Like, whatever that is that works like that for you is going to keep you alive for a long time.
It's weed, dude. It's weed.
It's amazing to me.
But I'm sitting there, right? So I'm like, I'll compose the email. I'm being patient because I'm like, this is all a test. How long does it take me to get to Jerry Bruckheimer without an agent? So I sit there composing the email. I'm like, dear Jerry, You may not remember me. We worked together very briefly on Coyote Ugly and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I had this thing I wanted to talk to you about, this hockey movie. If you get a chance, can you drop me a line? I left a phone number. And I sent the email. The next morning, dude, like maybe, 7, 8 o'clock in the morning, phone rings, like Jerry Bruckheimer calling for Kevin Smith. And I was like, right on, man. And I talked to him about the hockey thing. And it took me a total of 17 hours to get to the most powerful man in Hollywood by myself. And at that point, I was like, right on. Like, I'm not saying, screw agents. I hate my agent. I love my agent. He's a great guy. But I'm like, look, if I could do these things by myself, I mean, you're more invested at that point.
Mm.
Like, I've been that guy forever. When it comes to the movies, I don't just kind of sit back and do one thing. I do a bunch of things.
Yeah.
To not do that almost most important aspect of getting a ball rolling by getting in touch with somebody who could do something or blah, 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 or maybe would be interested. It was more of like, let me see if I could do this without help. Like, because that's what an agency is like. They look out for you. They set you up in meetings. But essentially, it's a Rolodex.
You're screwing with the whole protocol, though.
Yeah, but I mean, not if I keep my agency and use my agency for other stuff. Like, they made a nice chunk of money off me last year.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not like, oh, they're going to starve. But at the same time, I'm like, I'll never be able, this sounds dopey, and I don't mean this in a machismo way, and so I won't use the word man. I'll never be a grown-up unless I'm doing everything for myself. You know, it's like so many people are wonderful and do things for me, like, hey, here's your chocolate milk, you know, but that's how I became a fat ass. I don't walk to the fridge because somebody's like, here's the chocolate milk. Or I don't spend a bunch of time trying to get to Jerry Bruckheimer, so I spend a bunch of time shoving pie in my face. So for me, I'm like, let me try to do more by myself. And oddly enough, at the same time, you tend to lose a little weight along with it. It's just the more you take control of your situation, the more you take control of your business, the healthier you are. I don't know. It's just been a weird thing we've been experimenting with here at SModCo for the last year. And this has been my most productive year in show business.
Wow. That's amazing, man.
It's just so many things you can keep going if you don't have somebody going, wait, you should do that later. Like, if you got somebody strategizing behind you, that to me never works. I don't like strategies. Like, I'll come up with a strategy, but I don't need this kind of, okay, don't show these people yet. Show them later. There's a right time to show them. No, there's not. Show them when you show them.
It's been like this forever, though. Like, you know, showbiz and the movies and everything and television.
Know,
it's always been like this.
Now, when you think about it, there's not enough money going around anymore. Dude, the economy is in a weird place. So do you want to keep giving away more of your money to people that do things that you can do for yourself? Like, at that point, it's kind of like, look, I'm not swearing them off. I need them for certain things. But for other certain things, like if I can maintain that little piece for myself as opposed to giving 10% away because somebody connected me with a phone call, that's worth trying. You know what I'm saying? Because this 10%, that's a lot of money.
Hey, this question's coming in. Would you be involved with a half-hour comedy one-camera shoot that you didn't write if it was funny?
You know, somebody asked me that just the other day. There was a show that there's, I don't even want to say where it is, but it's a pretty cool place. They're setting up a show. And it's a cool place where you're like, oh, man, what a dream to work there. But it was on someone else's thing. They were like, hey, this dude's doing a show, and they need a writer. And I was just like, and this came from my agent. And this is one of my little issues, man. Like, my agent calls me up going, oh, my God, they called you about this. Isn't that cool? And I was like, have you not been listening to what I said for the last year, 2 years? Like, I'm moving away from this business. He's like, then why are you setting up so many TV shows? And I was like, oh, good point.
No, but I mean, if you were more than just a writer on it, like if you were like an exec producer on it, and like it was kind of done through your production company.
Yeah, in a heartbeat. Is it you?
Oh, yeah. Well, it is, but that wasn't what I was getting at. The listeners are just sending in questions.
But if it's you, in a heartbeat, like you, I know you, I like your sense of humor, I dig and whatnot. So that's something where I'm like, oh, I didn't create this world, but if I'm co-creating it with you.
I'm doing a comedy. It's about the Sandusky Boys Heinies, and it's an animated series.
Is that the title? Because I'm in it.
Yeah,
Boys Heinies.
Yeah, it's kind of like the Boys of Brazil.
People going like, I'm setting that on my TV. I don't know what it is.
Absolutely.
Oh, hell yeah.
Hey, Kevin, just to help you out a little bit, I know you're going to come back in August for it, but what is Bindle Stiffs about?
Bindle Stiffs is, it's remember in like high school, probably while I was in high school, maybe while you guys were in high school too, that's when all that stuff started about Catcher in the Rye, where people were like, we got to ban this book, man. It's no good for kids, and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
This is a story about like one of those days in high school where somebody's like, we're banning Catcher in the Rye. It's no longer be allowed to read in class. and the two boys in school go absolutely apeshit. Like, just lose it and go like, look, we'll never learn. We have to go to the city and lead a catcher in the rye type life. So they leave their small town to go to the city to try to relive catcher in the rye, wind up sucking dick, fucking homeless people. It's crazy.
Holy fuck.
It is phenomenal, dude. You never see where the movie's coming. Like, I know a lot of people are like, Hangover, bitch. This movie was way more surprising to me than Hangover. And, you know, it was also about, like, the weird things people get into. It's fantastic. I felt so lucky when we saw it because I was like, this is the perfect first movie for us because it's kind of like Clerks. Like, there's a movie that comes from nowhere, is made for peanuts, and it's very, very funny. At least I thought Clerks was funny. So to me, I was like, this should be the first movie that we take out in the road. And the boys are so cool. The boys, this dude named Andrew directed it. Smart kid. He's already got an agent and whatnot. He's going to go far. But it's so delightful when you watch a movie and, like, every laugh is original. You don't go like, all right, they're making a Star Wars joke or something like that. These cats stand on their own, man. They'll be working forever, Andrew and Luke. And the movie itself is so damn funny. And it's nice to be able to watch a funny movie and not be like, I'm jealous, I'm pissed, why didn't I do this? Like, now I just want to hitch my wagon to their star and be like, I know these guys.
Now, will it be in theaters, or are you going to do, like, the Red State thing?
We do, like, the Red State tour. We take it theater to theater. And we were doing New York and Philly and then Texas next week. But we'll do the same thing in August and then add a few more.
Right on.
And we'll go to mostly, like, kind of Bruin View type places or art houses. But it's kind of fun. We go, I intro'd a movie, we showed a movie, and then I get up to Q&A afterwards with Luke and Andrew and meet the crowd gets to meet them, ask them questions and stuff.
That's cool. I got to tell you, man, when you did that for Red State, that was so much fun.
Oh, God, I loved it. That was honestly the most fun I ever had in the film business in almost 20 years of doing it, releasing Red State. It was a pain in the ass, and, like, you know, it took up a lot of time, and every morning I was up at, like, 3 to kind of sell tickets back east and whatnot, but
right.
It was all mine, you know what I'm saying? Like, we controlled every aspect of it, and you put as much of yourself into it as you wanted to. Like, if somebody else was putting it out, they'd be like, here's the budget for the ads, you're going to go here and do this interview. You know, everything's taken care of for you, and you just show up, you're a cog in the machine. But with the distribution being in our court, like, us handling ourselves, every aspect you're responsible for. And for the person that's making the film, you know, I wrote it, directed it, edited it, to have even more control in the exhibition, oh, that was a dream come true. So it was like a rock concert every night, dude. I felt so young, and it was so awesome because I sat there. I didn't like, I'm going to go outside and smoke while you guys watch the movies. I sat there and watched every screening with the audience. And it was like, you know, you have a kid, and you raise a kid, and you enjoy every aspect of that kid's life. I got a daughter. I've enjoyed watching her grow up and stuff. The old way of, like, hey, I'm going to make a movie and then hand it to somebody else, and they're going to distribute the movie, always felt to me like, I had a baby. Now you take it and raise it, like just handing it over to a nanny.
Right.
When you distribute the movie yourself, man, it's like raising your kid and watching it grow and teaching it to walk and talk and all those things. So,
well, Kevin, two things about that. The reason I brought it up, I'm amazed no one did it before you, you know, and is more people doing it now that you showed them the way?
After I did it, and I don't know if it was like, hey, he's doing it, we could do it too. I don't know if it was an example or not, but shortly after we did Red State, Martin Sheen and Emilio Estevez took their movie The Way out on the road, same thing,
right.
Kind of four-walled it. What's his name? Francis Ford Coppola, the director of The Godfather. At Comic-Con last year was just like, hey, I'm going to take my movie out on the road and re-edit it at every location.
Oh, shit.
So it was so people started...
Hold on, what do you mean edited at a location? What do you mean, just to do something different? Like, what do you mean?
Like every time you saw the movie on the road with him, it was a different configuration. He would kind of edit it on the fly, which was really fascinating. So it was like, remember Clue back in the day? Everyone's like, there's a different ending every time you see it. And really, there was just four different endings.
Yeah.
This guy literally had a different configuration for every time that he shows
up, cool.
From what I understand.
Yeah, what?
It's you know what it is, man. It's not like everyone's going, hey, let's all do it, because in the business of the arts, many people, lazy fat asses, don't want to do anything for themselves.
That's
I was
right.
One of those people for a long, long time. But as we kind of bridge this weird economy where, like, the math, the financial math of the entertainment business changes every day. Like, they're still now trying to squeeze pennies out of a dollar based on old video deals, but, like, it's all going away. Everything's different now.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, you know, the smart artist who wants to work in the arts for a living, like, that's what I want to do. I just want to be a kid forever and get paid to play. if I want to continue doing that, I got to figure out ways to kind of make myself useful, make myself some cash without, you know, going the normal route or the old route, which is now kind of closed off. And I was kind of done with at that point anyway.
It's interesting to me, though, because it's a ballsy thing to do, man. I feel like no matter what I do, however I venture out, it's going to flop. And I guess that's what everybody's scared of, which is why the guys who like, you know, Louis puts out his thing online, you take Red State on the road. That's why these are considered ballsy moves, because it is scary to do it.
But it is. It's kind of like you said, though. Like, I think every artist that puts himself into something, whether you're an actor, whether you're a musician, whether you're a director, writer, what have you, no matter, dancer, we're all afraid of flopping. Like, that's the secret fear. It's like, I don't care who you are, if you're the most confident cat in the business, there's always going to be a moment of like, what if I'm wrong? What if this sucks? Because this is so arbitrary, this job. It's not like math where it's just like everything's got to add up or the rocket won't go into space. It's arbitrary. It's a matter of taste. And tastes change all the time. Like, you know, I was in a hotel room the other night when I was at Albuquerque, and I was like, you know what? Holy crap, American Reunion's on. I didn't see it. I'll watch American Reunion. And I'm like, they did everything that they did kind of in American Pie, but what's the difference? And it's just like tastes have changed.
Yeah.
Things have moved on. So in order to kind of stay relevant, you know, because this is what I want to do until I die. I just want to make stuff up, and it's a great job, and the money's cool, don't get me wrong, but it's the best way to live, dude. I always feel like I'm 16 years old. I may look like I'm, you know, a haggard 60, but I feel inside like I'm 16. It keeps you young. So if I want to do that, I got to keep creating new ways to stay fresh. And, like, yeah, for me, my new mantra is, like, you got to surprise the audience every few months with something completely out of left field. When we announced the spoiler show on Hulu, man, people were like, what? And then it was on a week and a half later. So we were like, hey, we're doing this thing. And people were like, what is that thing? Wait, you're doing a movie review show? And then a week and a half later, boom, here is that thing.
Yeah.
So, and that's something that most people didn't expect, because they were like, he hates critics. And I was like, yeah, well, if you hate something, change it.
I want to ask you, did you see Prometheus?
I did.
What'd you think?
We talk about it today. It's on.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the show. Hulu spoiler. If you go to Hulu right now, Hulu.com, the new episode of Spoilers just went up this morning, and it's we see Prometheus, and then we sit down and talk to the writer Damon Lindelof.
Yeah, he's been catching some heat from some steadfast alien people.
They're mad because not enough aliens in it.
I guess because it was supposed to originally be a straightforward prequel, and then they decided to make it kind of a prequel and a standalone story because they were going to go in that direction, and then doing both kind of did neither almost. I don't know.
Yeah, you know, when you watch it, like I remember I went sat down, I was looking for aliens, and then it turns out, oh, it's Alien, which makes sense because Ridley Scott made it.
Yeah.
So if you're looking for, you know, the bank slam of like, aliens, and like, why don't you put her in charge? All that stuff.
Yeah.
Just rewatch Aliens. But this one is closer to the tone of Alien, and as much as it's
definitely
more like gothic haunted house movies.
Yeah, definitely. That's what I thought. It was, there were just a couple of aspects of the story I was kind of like, I'm not sure about a couple of things. Visually, it was fucking amazing.
It was like a 70s album cover. It was so beautiful.
Yeah, wow, 70s really? Album cover. It was on the IMAX screen. The Prometheus landing sequence was fucking unbelievable. It was vast. Just fucking huge. And, but the story, something about it was just kind of like a little disjointed. I don't know.
Did you think that Prometheus landed on its engines? Like, it had these kind of rotating engines that allowed it to do like a, was that helicopter that goes?
Yeah, through? Like an Osprey or a Harrier jet.
Like a Harrier jet.
Yeah.
But I'm watching it land, and I was like, wait, where's the landing gear? It looked like it landed, like its engines inverted and then landed on
it. Yeah, it turned, and the engines almost had like landing gear on the bottom of them. Yeah, it was weird. Looked great, though.
It did look great. And to me, it actually made more sense. I'm like, wouldn't you want your engines right on the ground for takeoff? Because that would thrust you a little harder.
You would think.
I was doing a little science in the sci-fi.
I was also thinking of, the other day I started thinking about Predators, because I was, you know, the alien Predator thing and all that. And you start really thinking, like, the Predators have ships.
Right.
And they had to be fucking built by somebody, but the Predators themselves are so like almost native savage kind of things with technology. But did they build it? Are there the fucking Predator bean counters that have to make sure that the ships come in at cost?
What's that?
Think about it, in every culture, you know, there's going to be the strong and the weak. So obviously the Predators that we see from their culture are the dominant. And then there are a bunch of dudes who are more cuckolds, if you will, who are like, they look like predators, but they're like, you, do the dishes.
Yeah, they never show those predators. Oh, the guy that's being yelled at by his boss because the fucking, you know, the little shoulder-mounted laser thing didn't come in at cost.
Or you never see the scene where the predator can't work the fry machine at McDonald's.
Yeah. It's just... I don't know. They never show those guys. And the big claws on him just doesn't seem conducive to turning nuts and bolts. I don't fucking know.
Someone back on their planet with smaller fingers.
Maybe that's it. Another species.
Did you see Predators when they put everyone on a planet with a bunch of predators?
Yeah, I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They keep trying to find new ways to be like, and now this thing meets this, and now it meets
this.
Yeah. But I'll go with it, man. Like, once you like those characters, you're like, all right, I'll see this permutation.
Yeah, yeah, hell yeah. So what's the deal with the high school kids or something? You got something going? Roland was saying that. Like, you're involved in some project that some kids are doing?
Is that Bindle? Oh, okay.
I thought it was something.
No, I swear. Me and Jimmy are looking at each other like he might have had a stroke or something.
No, I thought it was a different.
Oh, okay, yeah.
The kids and the boys. What about the?
Oh my God. Me and Jimmy looked at each other.
Dress.
Yeah.
No, I thought it was something. I thought it was a different project. That yeah. Okay. Was talking
hey,
about.
Man, have you talked to Jerry Bruckheimer since you got us? Shut up.
I want to see. We got a copy of Bindle Stiffs. I can't wait to see it now.
Dude, it's funny. Watch it. I'm serious. I wouldn't lead you wrong. It's fucking funny. You will laugh. You'll laugh hard, and you'll be like, "Holy shit!"
Can I do screenings until you get here in August? Set up a few places and.
Hell yeah. Help us out, brother.
I know my doorman would love a copy of this movie.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Bootleg.
All right, my doorman might bootleg movies illegally. I don't know.
$10 a pop? How much do you charge?
He fucking hits me up all the time. He's like, I got a really good copy. They're not talking much. It's unbelievable.
Shot over somebody's fucking shoulder in a movie.
Oh, I guarantee he has Prometheus already. But it's like, you know, you see some people's heads for a little while, but 10 minutes in, it's great. I got one of those guys in my life.
Can I attempt something real quick?
Yeah.
We started a YouTube channel not too long ago. It's called YouTube/CSMOD, SEESMOD. And there's clips on it, man, that I think you would find fascinating. There's me singing Grease. There's me and we do a show.
Oh, man.
We do a show called Smarkive, and it's basically all video clips from the past, everything pre-Clerks, things that led us up to what we do for a living.
Oh,
so
wow.
The first one we did was like me and Muse had a video camera, and we were just driving around one night. I'm 20, he's 16, and it's unbelievable.
Wow.
He is a proto version of Muse, and it's me without a beard talking in a very thick Jersey accent. So we put that up. People fell in love with it. And then the one that I put up last week was from Grease. It was me and my mom introduced the clips, and I keep throwing to me singing Grease Lightning. Dude, you've never seen a fatter Kinnicky. go peep it out. You'll be very, very happy. There's also cartoons on the channel. We do Hollywood Babylon there, Jay and Silent Bob Get Old there. There's a funny show called Comic Head where the dude reviews comics in a very, very funny way. It's fun stuff. It's all free, man. You know, that's my model. My model is like, just make a bunch of shit. Make anything you want and give it away for free. You just can't expect to get paid for the things you love. But then you find that thing that, like, people love, that they want, and hopefully you get paid on that. So we keep creating free content, man. Even the Hulu show on spoilers, you don't even need to have a subscription. It helps if you do, but if you don't, you could literally watch the show there for free.
Oh, there you are. Jesus.
Pretty good goddamn idea.
It's all about free, dude. Give it away for free, and then when you show up in their hometown with a live show, then, you know, they'd come see you.
Right.
You're giving them so much free. Like, people in the podcasting business keep trying to, like, make money off of advertising. That's how, you know, they try to turn it into TV or radio and go, like, this is the only way to make money. You know, we put ads on our podcasts, and that's how we collect money. That's fine. That's one way to do it. But I honestly feel like podcasts are simply meant to be commercials for the live show. If you're sitting there listening to all those, just like you guys, every morning they sit there and listen to you for free. And whenever and if ever you guys go out and decide to do a live show, what happens? It sells out, man, because people are like, we love these guys, and we've been hearing them for free for so long, so this is their payback. So that's been the financial model we've been working off. And as much as people will tell you, like, yeah, I've got audible.com on my podcast and stuff, that's great. I don't begrudge them that at all, but that's peanuts, dude. The real money is like when you put up a bunch of podcasts and then you walk out into a 3,200-seat theater and it's packed. And you ask those people, how many people are here because they heard the podcast? And 90% of the hands go up and people are cheering and stuff.
Wow.
That's, That to me is the trade-off. Like, keep your advertising money and stuff. That's fine. I just want to put asses in seats when we go on the road. And so far, our audience has been fantastic about it. So we keep just giving, generating free content for them. For years, it was all about, here's my movie, pay to see it or buy the DVD. Now it's like, go to our YouTube channel, watch all the crap there for free. Go to SModcast.com, listen to all that crap for free. Go to Hulu, watch spoilers for free. And it just keeps building, man. And because of that, then we could go out on the road and sell more shows. It's amazing.
It's a brand new type of strategy.
He's on to something good, man.
It's the oldest strategy in the book. Artists... like a music artist back in the day, they play their song on the radio, and then when they go tour, you go see them live. Same kind of thing.
I think you might be onto something, Kevin Smith.
It's working so well. Yeah. Even if it's not insanely lucrative, which, by the way, it is, it's fun. More than anything else, I'm having a good time. Like, every morning I get up, and I go, what do we do today, man? Like, because you just keep creating stuff, put it in motion, and see what happens.
Mm, fucking, that's great, man. Very good.
Right, boys, I'm sorry I monopolized.
No, not at all. No.
I'm going to call you when I'm in L.A. I'll be in L.A. at the end of June.
Please do. And there is, just to put a pin in it, there's some action on Hit Somebody. So I'll let you know about that soon.
Oh, yeah. Good, good. If any dialogue, I can start going over.
Totally. And I want to give you enough heads up where you can build some time into your schedule and whatnot.
And I really want to do it with my I'm going to do my best Quincy impression. That's the character I've decided. Jesus.
Do it again.
Quincy. It's going to be all Quincy. We got to hit the puck in the net, Sam.
I love it.
The ice was melting.
I think the best thing to do here, because Kevin's got so much going on, that Kevin Smith on Twitter. Yes. Is the easiest way.
There, yeah, I'm always on Twitter. Hit me up there.
Or smodcast.com, obviously.
Or Hulu. Go to Hulu and watch spoilers. I tell you, man. All right. It's a fun show. Fun show. And they can watch it right now.
All right, let's do that.
That's great.
All right, boys. Thank you so much. I'm going to come and hang out with you guys for a long time.
Sorry about the devils.
Yes, sir.
By the way,
yes.
So. Sorry about the devils.
No, dude, no. You've got to believe. Believe in Brodeur, bitch.
He is tough.
He's showing people up, dude. He's out there windmilling. He's flopping and stuff. He's stacking the fucking pads. And you'll find no end of people criticize. Well, he's 40. He's stacking the pads. That's his only move. Meanwhile, he's fucking fighting for the Stanley Cup. The guy's the greatest goalie in the world right now. Give it to him.
All
right.
Well, it's given to him.
Yeah.
It has been given.
All right, Kevin. We'll see you when you come through New York.
See you, buddy.
Thanks, boys.
Kevin, everyone. And we'll break in.
He's
we'll
right,
finish
though.
Up next.
He's fucking right.
Yeah, I know.
He's
I
right.
Know. Well, we got a great agent. He does.
Ah, the agent. We got to do. We got to push the agent. We tell the agent, this is what you're doing now. I don't rely on them.
Yeah.
No. Mm-hmm. I don't trust any of them. Mm-hmm. I'm in on everything with my fucking career. Honestly.
See, but Kevin isn't in a position also where he's got to answer to a company like this place. We can go out and do what
sure.
we want, but they're all going to be down our fucking necks.
No, I don't mean that, but if we want Bob to do something, we got to get on the phone with Bob and go, this is what we want,
right.
and we want it by Tuesday,
right.
and that's it. And then follow up a management and go, did Bob talk to you? Did you talk to Bob? Whatever the fuck it is.
Yeah.
Stay on top of all of them. I don't let any of them fucking breathe.
I agree with you. I agree with you, Jimmy.
We're going to come back with another Suzyn Waldman clip.
Oh, nice.
That Travis just handed me.
Is it good?
No, it's terrible.
Laugh your tears away. Laugh your tears away. Laugh your tears away. Fucking retard. Life. Fuck you, your nosy body. Get your own fucking life. Fuck
guilty body. Fuck you. Bye bye. Bye bye. Fuck you. Away, fucking retard brain. Laugh your tears away. Laugh your tears away. Take your medication before you kill a child. Laugh your tears away. Laugh your tears away. Get your own fucking life.
This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
All right. We got one more Suzyn Waldman clip. Did we do everything from the weekend? That fucking Triple Crown thing was a bummer, huh?
What a bust.
I'll have another fucking...
Scratched.
Huh?
You're talking about Pacquiao?
Ah, yeah, something happened there, whatever. I'm more about the Triple Crown thing.
You're supposed to be up on sports, Opie, if you want
I am up on sports. Okay. The Triple Crown, this is what I would have done. They scratched him because they need that valuable cum out of the horse. So I would have squeezed the balls of I'll have another and get all the cum out. So
personally?
They can make, so they can, yeah, what the fuck, man? $1 million horses that's going to produce. Multi-million dollar horses. So you squeeze the cum out of I'll have another. You freeze that shit so you can make more thoroughbreds. And then you run that shit to see if he can do the Triple Crown, even though he had a bad tendon. What happened?
You got to get the jizz. You can't get the jizz and freeze it like that.
What do you mean?
Horse jizz, very delicate.
You can't freeze horse jizz.
No, it's like a you get paid like $100,000 or something. They were saying
per
fucking horse that gets fertilized with it.
Right.
But if it would have lost or gotten injured and had to be put down.
Yeah, that's an investment.
Yeah, that's why I thought you could scratch it.
That's why I thought you could get all the jizz out. But you're telling me that shit doesn't stay.
No, I don't think you're able to really freeze it.
I didn't know that.
Well, he's there with a broken leg. You're just jerking him off before they kill him on the fucking side of the court, trying to get a load out of him.
Some chicks just blowing the horse, laying down. They were like, some guy standing over it with a gun to its head.
Quick, finger his ass.
Once he shoots, so will I.
What was the tendon injury? Do you know? What did it step
tendonitis.
On? Tendonitis.
Just had some tendonitis.
So you run that shit.
Run it out. Walk it off.
I bet you that's a part of it, though, man. The amount of money they would lose if he fucking died.
That's exactly why they did it. I'm fucking around, but you gotta protect the sperm over having a Triple Crown.
Yeah, definitely. That's where they make their money.
Oh wow, that's a drag. Who ended up winning the race? I didn't give a fuck about Belmont because of this whole thing.
I didn't do anything.
They were so bummed out. I heard on the news that they were expecting 100,000 people at the event.
Yeah, yeah.
And it went down to 50.
Yep.
They lost half because he wasn't running. In
the horse that won was Waldman Saliva.
Oh, really? Wow, what a coincidence.
Here comes Waldman's Saliva around the turn. And she's passing Sterling's Crutch. Sterling's Crutch is coming in second. Waldman's Saliva rounding the turn. Michael K. got out early. Is coming up third.
Posada New on the outside.
Posada New. Catchphrase hack.
But moving around turn three, it's George's box. All of our dumb sayings.
Yeah. By that would mean coffin.
And because Sam was being a wise ass, I know about the Pacquiao thing. But boxing is fucking, it's corrupt as all hell. We all know that.
Yes.
What's the surprise here? Another fight that should have went the other way.
It stinks.
We can play all the audio, but that's what boxing does. They give a fuck about, the money way, way more than the actual sport itself. So now they set up for what? The rematch, which is going to be a lot more money for everybody.
And people are blaming the Athletic Commission, which I know it's them, but don't think that boxing doesn't have a tremendous amount of influence because of the amount of money they bring into Vegas. There's a lot of behind-the-scenes stuff. And I wouldn't be surprised. Oh, yeah, it's the Fatistas, the non-union casino, and that's why the shitty unions here are protesting MMA in New York. But I guarantee you somehow fucking boxing is behind that.
Yeah.
Boxing does not want MMA legal everywhere.
It's a dirty sport.
They'll take too much of their cut.
Absolutely.
From what they're making from boxing. But there's no surprise. Everyone's outraged. It's like, really? This has been going on for what? We get one of these every other year it's a horrible decision. I was telling Jimmy before the show, UFC, rarely is it a bad decision.
Right.
Rarely. Could you name one off the top of your head? You watch all the time.
No, I mean,
you know what I mean?
John Jones being the victory being taken from him because of the elbow, which was illegal, but that annoyed me. But I mean, that might have been the right call, technically.
Right, right.
He should be 16-0 or 17-0.
Yeah. I mean, so you want to play the audio from Pacquiao? God, hard to say for me. We don't need to, right?
Well, what's the audio? Is it them objecting?
Oh, it's the judge's decision, the announcer's commentary.
Oh, yeah, I would like to hear that. I'm actually curious.
All surprise. Tim Bradley's post-fight interview, basically saying, what the fuck? And then Bob Arum going, oh, I don't know what the fuck
Bob
happened.
Arum's a cunt.
Oh, jeez, this is wrong. We better have a rematch so we can see who really won the fight.
Yeah, he's a cunt.
It's all so predictable.
Michael Buffer is standing by with the official results. Let's go to him right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the MGM Grand, we go to the scorecards. Jerry Roth scores about 115-113 for Pacquiao. CJ Ross scores it 115-113 for Bradley. And Dwayne Ford scores it 115-113 to the winner by split decision. And new WBO welterweight champion of the world, the Desert Storm, Timothy.
Everyone's saying Bradley didn't win, huh?
Everyone is saying he didn't win, and especially if you're taking a guy's belt, you have to really beat him.
Yeah.
You have to really fucking beat a guy to take his belt. Did anybody seeing this fight think that Pacquiao really lost and people are wrong? Maybe I'm wrong.
No, not really.
Well, I'll tell you. I don't think we're blind. I think Harold Lederman is the best scorer alive, and I think that is a terrible bogus decision.
I'm dumbfounded. I don't know what to say. I mean, that's where they started off the 115 and 113. And I have no comment. I'm totally confused.
I'm as confused as anyone could possibly be. Jinky Pacquiao's reaction at ringside. Timothy Bradley has scored an upset split decision victory over Manny Pacquiao. God only knows how.
Yeah, and I mean, if both announcers are saying what a hard, and they were right there.
It sounds like it was going to be a unanimous decision if they were asked.
No, they would have just said it. Wouldn't they say unanimous decision first?
No, I'm saying these guys are assuming it was the other way, and it was going to be unanimous how they're talking. Here's Bradley.
Terrible.
I didn't hear what Bradley had to say. You think he's like, yeah, of course I won, or is he surprised? Well, let's find out.
You hear the reaction of the crowd. Ringside, we had Pacquiao up by a considerable margin. It seemed to us that you guys thought you'd lost the fight at the end of the fight. Tell me about it.
Now, you know what? It was a good fight. It was a good competitive fight. Every round was pretty close. Pacquiao, you know, he won some of the early rounds. The later rounds, I controlled the action with my jab, moving. You know, I got to go back home, review the tape, and I'll see if I won the fight or really done.
How does it feel to have the official verdict to have won, to have beaten Manny Pacquiao?
I mean, it feels great. It feels great, but I'm not satisfied. You know, you can hear the boos in the crowd. You know, everybody in the crowd think I lost the fight. I know it's predominantly Pacquiao fans, but you know what? Let's do it again. Let's do it again.
He knows he lost.
You said you wanted to go back and look at the tape. What are you looking for?
Well, I'm going to see if I won the fight or not. You know, I was in here. I thought it was a close match. Let me go back, watch the tape, and see if I won the fight.
Wow.
That's pretty much it.
An honest answer from an honest fighter.
You almost feel bad for him. At least he told
the
truth.
He was trying to spin in the beginning and then realized, all right, well, fuck, what's going on here?
But that's the speech a champion has to give. Right. That right there, this is why boxing, you stink.
Yeah.
Because that's the speech your new champion has to give. I'm going to go back and watch the tape and see if I won the fight.
You know, yeah, is that really a good
fucking
thing?
Fucking sport. Again, the athletes are not the problem, but the people behind boxing are fucking disgusting.
It's unbelievable.
Disgusting.
Bob Arum, was he the promoter of this fight, obviously?
Yeah, and he was representing both fighters.
Is he? So it's perfect for him.
But you can't fix fights without the fighters being involved. That's why it doesn't
if
work.
If they fix it. But if it's a fixed fight, then all of a sudden it doesn't look like Pacquiao won if he lost.
Exactly. That's why if you're going to fix the results, you have to tell the fighters.
That's why maybe it wasn't a fixed fight. There has to be a way.
No, they got
to
fight their asses off, but then behind the scenes, everyone knows, well, if Bradley wins here.
Yeah, exactly.
If it's close enough, you know, hint, hint, maybe you should give it to Bradley because then we could get another fight out of this.
Right.
I think that shit goes on, to be honest with you.
Yeah, that's what they're doing. They want that rematch.
Yeah, these guys can't. I would imagine it's really hard to fix a fight in this day and age. So they fight their asses off. But if it's close, maybe some.
But
some talking is going behind the scenes. If it's close, it wouldn't be the worst thing if you give it to the other guy.
When does this rematch take place? A year and a half?
November.
Yeah. Okay.
Right away. Here's Bob Arum.
This is a fight that respected people, scored it 11-1, 10-2. Everybody was talking how Bradley was trying hard.
I didn't know Bob Levy was promoting fights.
But it was a mismatch, and then to hear scores like we heard tonight, it's unfathomable. Unfathomable. You look at the punch stats, you look at, with your own eyes, what you saw. I mean, there's no way I can explain it. Now, I've been in places where their hometown decisions that are outrageous, but wink, wink, you knew what was happening. I don't think anything was happening here, except these people don't know how to score.
Wow, that's Bob Arum?
They really don't.
Wow.
They really don't. Two of the judges were judging fights when I first came to Las Vegas, and the truth is they're too damn old to judge anymore. That's the truth. And the third judge, the lady, I don't think she's ever done a championship fight before. What the hell were these people, all three of them, including the one they called the 7-5 from Pacquiao, what were they looking at?
Yeah.
Good for Bob. Know what? I fucking shouldn't have blasted Bob Arum.
It's in his best...
It's in his best interest to...
In his best interest, because now he's going to make a shitload more money off these two.
But the way he just blasted that, though...
Just be blaming it on the judges.
Yeah, but now he's covering his ass a little bit. Like, what the fuck? This what?
What's his other option?
They had a woman judge in there?
Yeah, you know.
That's the athletic commission. I tell you why.
Oh, boy.
When you're fucking...
But they also said the one scorer was the best in the business.
But he's saying even the guy that said 7-5 Pacquiao, what were you looking at? Like, when the promoter comes out like that blatantly, when has both fighters, and is that... That doesn't sound like a guy covering his ass. That sounds like a guy who's genuinely irritated by it. Mm. Covering your ass sounds more like, you know what... it looked to me like it was close, but I'll have to watch it again because he didn't give mince words at all.
Yeah, but he's happy it turned out this way.
That's what's weird,
you know?
Yeah.
He don't give a fuck. In the end, he wants to promote fights that will bring him the most money, and now a rematch is going to be the best thing that could happen to Bob Arum.
That athletic...
Which makes it weird, too.
The athletic commission may be fucking... You know what? They simply... may just be fucking beholden to other interests that have nothing to do with UFC, nothing to do with boxing. Big gamblers who maybe run things behind the scenes or big odds makers may have a lot to do with what these shithead athletic commission people.
But my dumb point when I saw the headline, I'm like, oh, this again.
Yeah.
We've seen it a million fucking times. No surprise.
And do boxing fans actually want to see a rematch of this now? Or are they just fed up with it?
No. What? Do they want to see this fight?
A rematch.
Yeah. I mean, of course they do.
What for? I mean, they thought they were going to see it the first time.
Pacquiao should have won. So now they're like, holy fuck.
So what if they just misjudge it again?
Well, then you get the third fight, which is, or now,
just keep, like,
Pacquiao wins, then it's 1-1, and then you do get the third fight.
But they just, they're being suckered. Like, don't the boxing fans?
No, wrestling fans are being suckered.
No, wrestling fans know it's fixed. No,
yeah, boxing fans should stop buying the pay-per-views.
Yeah, wrestling fans are not buying something to see something that's not fixed or predetermined.
Mm. More importantly, people are all over the place with the frozen horse sperm. They're saying Ant's wrong, that they freeze it now in liquid hydrogen, supposedly.
What?
But then other people saying to be an actual racehorse, it's got to happen naturally. You can't, like, shove sperm in the... And the female horse?
I know what brings the most money. And that's nice, fresh cum.
You see the donkey video from Fear Factor? Talked about on our show?
I did indeed. And that's
finally
fucked
made
up.
Made the light of day. I'm sure it's on our Facebook or by now.
Chicks fucking just chugging
gobbling
down
donkey sperm
and donkey piss.
Club Soda Kenny seems to have the answer on the frozen semen question.
Oh. What does he say?
He's texting me. He says, from outside the room for some reason. He says, you can't race a horse bred from frozen semen. Thoroughbred horse racing requires that all breeding be done live.
Well, who's watching the breeding?
That's a good question, too.
If I was a horse owner, I'm like, nah, it happened naturally. I go? And then I go, where do I go? Where's my stable?
I bet you need pictures of the horse fucking him.
That's probably so you can't fucking... that's obviously so you can't manipulate the DNA and fucking pump in stuff.
Who gives a fuck?
Hey, what about
the steroids? Give him whatever the fuck. I don't care.
Speaking of horses, what did Suzyn Waldman say in the new?
Oh, you want that? All right, let's end with this.
I like yogurt.
We asked Travis for more Suzyn Waldman audio. One of the announcers for the Yankees. And
I've cracked the code. The best Suzyn Waldman is right after a home run because she does a pre-show, she does an after-show,
which is mellow.
And, nice and mellow and this and that. But the excitement of a home run.
Gets her going.
Gets her pussy moist.
Yep.
Gets everything, all the juices flowing.
That's why her mouth is so full of liquid.
And I left in, you'll hear at the end, John just doesn't give back.
Oh, really?
Oh, why doesn't John give back?
3-0 Mets. Bottom of the 7th, 2 outs, a runner at first pitch. Swung on and drilled to right. And that ball is going to be, it's going to be gone. Oh, Russell Martin just cleared the jump of Scott Hairston and hit it in the first row in right. His home runs have been going to right center. Russell, he shows muscle. Monsieur Martin est là. He line drives a home run in the right field seats, and the Yankees trail 3-2.
And David Wright still looking at that and looked at it again on the board. Don't forget, Wright makes a better throw, and they are out of the inning. Let's see where this ball was. Hairston goes up over. Well, the ball hit the top of the wall and bounced into the stands. Hairston didn't miss it by much. It went just to the glove length, about right to the right of the glove, about the length of a glove. He was in the wrong spot.
Here's Jason Nix. Hits ground ball.
Shit. I won't kill her on that because to me that was legit what she said. She was just painting the picture of what happened. But that fucking Sterling, he hates her.
Nothing. Dead silence.
She gives him 30 seconds.
Shut up, bitch.
Of information.
Yeah.
He just doesn't have any of it.
Yeah, they're all of a sudden they're going to talk about Nix. What is he? Nixing off? What is he with the New York Knickerbockers or something?
What?
I'm going to compile a lot of
that. That was a glove length. How about a glove width or something?
It's so bad.
Horse semen, says. What are you doing? Are there little horses that are out there like in the Navy or something?
Right, semen.
Or something.
Sure, semen. Yeah. Oh, man.
All right, y'all.
So, hey, hold on. I finished. Hey, sister, how was Nicole's wedding with mashup? Did you have mashed potatoes or something?
Oh.
There were no mashed potatoes.
You did go, though,
Chick
right?
Waldman. Yes. It was a lovely affair. It was a good party.
Did she get
that's
drunk?
That's all I need to hear.
She got, she was intoxicated.
Sasa, how come she wasn't out of intoxicated or something?
Out of intoxicated? Just say out intoxicated.
If she was intoxicated.
Yeah, he says out of intoxicated.
I didn't say in of toxicated.
No,
in
no,
or
you
out,
didn't.
Not out of.
You didn't.
Moist mouth.
It was fun, though.
That's good.
Oh, my God.
Hey, how come you're eating blueberries or something? Why aren't you eating red berries?
What? What, Chuck Berry?
That's not funny. Why would you say that when it was a glove locked away, Anthony?
Sorry, Chip Waldman.
So my mother was a saint on earth or something.
Or something. Why would she exclaim or something?
Force a habit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Grandison looks like, he looks like the guy that would help my mother with the floorboards.
Or something.
Or something.
Or something.
How come I'm not Chip Waldwoman or something?
No, you're Chip Waldman.
Yeah, you're a man.
For this one day. The one day.
Yeah, don't count on it. It was supposed to be a one-break character or something. I feel this one catching on because I feel like Daffy Duck or something.
Of people tweeting you?
Why is the suffer? Why is the succotash suffering or something? Why don't they put out his misery?
Oh my god.
Suffering succotash.
Or suffering succotash.
Is suffering succotash from upstate New York or something?
Suffering?
Yeah. Oh god. Chip Waldman's kind of fun.
No, she's not. He's not.
Uh huh. She.
Cocksucker.
Shut the fuck up.
Fuck. The Opie and Anthony show is pretty much over.
Pretty much over. Pretty much over.
But if you feel like sticking around after 1A Live is next.